all of us, I'm sure, are happy about digitization. Some of us could be, of course, scared. I am also scared. Because while digitization is a great comfort, it also poses certain threats. By a press of button, somebody could blind my computer and my server completely, and for a few minutes I may lose all the data and files which I have. But thanks God Almighty, you have systems in place today where the data which you lose is available somewhere, and you could retrieve that with the expertise of the kind which the digitization offers to you. So you have both sides of the coin, and it would be important for universities of India, for that region, universities around the world, to assimilate the dimension of digitization with full faith, with full submission, because this could be a great solace for each one of us. For example, if I want to know who studied with me, I'll have to search my house to find the directory or the album which was given to me at the time of graduation way back in 1969. Maybe it would have been lost by this time. But digitization can help me to retrieve my batchmates, and then I can realize that Professor S.P. Singh was with me as my very dear friend sitting next to me in the classroom. I could link up with courage and confidence and create this vital synergy of mine. So digitization is important. It is also being seen as a threat. People are thinking that tomorrow computers will teach in the classroom, teachers may not be required, and we will lose our job. I am of the opinion that even vice chancellors may not be required if the prophecy goes like this, which means the university would be governed and managed by the intelligence of the machine, except that sometimes it may say, thank you, vice chancellor, that you are around. Give a smile which I cannot give. But leaving those threats aside, tremendous amount of bliss is also around with the use of modern science and technology. It's also important for us to integrate with the statutory bodies who boss around and tell us do this and don't do that. As a vice chancellor of the university which we are, often we are told that create separate structures for architecture and planning. And even within architecture and planning, they want architecture here and planning there, not integrated like this. A professor of planning cannot teach architecture. A professor of architecture cannot teach planning. This is the situation we are confronting as of today. Therefore, the Council of Architecture is very important for us. I had serious trouble in my life when I became Vice Chancellor of Technical University. The degree of architecture was with us in the Technological University. I thought it's an engineering degree, so by mistake I wrote BE Architecture. And all the professors of architecture and heads of the architecture school came rushing. How dare you Christian our degree as the Bachelor of Engineering in Architecture? I said, what else are you? You are no longer the art of sketching, the drawings and dimensions. Today you are carrying out all your designs using computer-aided design and the tools of AutoCAD. You are assessing the designs for strength. You are assessing the designs for environment, energy, recycle, reusability, assessing its efficacy, and all this. This is all engineering. But I could not convince them. They said, sooner you correct it as Bachelor of Architecture. Don't even write Bachelor of Architecture and Planning. So the importance of statutory bodies can be seen. How do I take care of this dimension? They want a separate library for them. They want a separate computer center for them. They want a separate head of institution, of course. They want head of the department and professors isolated from the main body of the university. That's the dilemma. I'm sure each one of us must be facing this. And yet, we are making phenomenal progress on architecture and planning. Make no mistake that India stands much taller today in its strength in architecture and planning compared to any other nation in the world. In fact, I visited the world capital of architecture, that is Chicago, and I was told that all these minarets which you see here, marvels which you see, are designed by Indian architecture. That's the kind of faith which has been generated. So the rigidity which they implemented also worked as wonders. We have to respect that. How do I assimilate in my quest for integration? Last but not the least, I have a few more partners here in my progress. Chairman of NCRI, National Council of Rural Institutes, is also here. For a very long time, we thought that rural should be developed as rural and urban as urban. Till such time, we discovered that we can expand our urban area to cover all rural, so that the mineral water and all goodies which you have in the urban areas could reach to the rural areas. And today I invite you to go for a marriage ceremony in the villages. You should not be surprised that mineral water is being served. And all goodies, including paneer and whatnot we were eating in the urban areas, now they are also in the rural areas. Good quality road network has happened, electricity has gone there, mechanization of agriculture is taking place rapidly. But, and that's where I think our chief of ICRI is here to tell us, how do I create more jobs in the rural area and ensure that the exodus population that is taking place from rural to urban can be heralded. And if I can't do that, I'll continue to create slums in my urban areas and running from pillar to post to solving these problems. Last but not the least, we have the FICCI, the Federation of Indian Chamber of Commerce and Industry. Our education will have no value if prosperity is not created. Our education would have no value if nation's economy is not robust and strong. Our education would have no value if we are not able to transact and trade much of what we produce in our country, both nationally as well as internationally. Therefore, the strong connect with the corporate and strong connect with the industry is the need of the hour. In this important session, we are privileged to have with us the heads of the apex bodies or their representatives. And I would like each one of them to tell us how best we can utilize this opportunity of creating the synergy of mind, a collaborative and cooperative spirit, creating that partnership for progress at a time when India needs it most compared to any other country in the world. To begin with, may I take this opportunity to introduce to you to my vice chairman of the session, Dr. Sancheti. Dr. Sancheti is a tall man in his own order, a former director of NIT Suratkal, which was one of the topmost NITs in the country during his tenure, and I believe it is still is. Dr. Sancheti had been the vice chancellor of Manipal University and now with SRM University. He has seen the best of both the worlds, which means the world of government and government-run universities and institutions and the world of leading private universities. He would be my co-chair to help me to assimilate the thoughts of this session. Before any further, but being between you and the learned speakers, may I take this opportunity to invite Dr. Tripathi, Indian Council of Agriculture Research. Most important, I pose you some questions, sir. Agriculture had done a lot of good to us, and I'm proud of that. I was very hungry when I was a child. Even the grains were coming from America to make chapatis in our household. Today we are the net exporter as far as the food is concerned. But then, tremendous amount of problems have been created. Tell us why farmers are committing suicide despite all the development which we have made. Tell us why the rural areas where agriculture takes place are devoid of good quality water today compared to the best quality of water which I had in my village. Tell us why the environmental management of our agriculture areas is posing such a serious threat that even the national capital should hit the headline with 999 of air quality, much of this being contributed by burning of the stubble from the agriculture. Also tell us, how can I economize on water tomorrow while cultivating my fields? How do I ensure that a country of 1.3 billion people, which we are, is in a position to feed itself without draining the resources of the kind which we have drained in the past for our agriculture sector? These are some of the burning issues. Also tell us about cutting edge areas of research which are going on. Also tell us how you are going to ensure that the food of tomorrow which be as healthy as the human habitat would require, and tell us how we are going to create really food, vegetable, as well as the oil-bearing seeds of tomorrow, which will provide assurance of survival to 100 years without catching any disease. Make no mistake, fellow vice chancellors, your president is at least one who never had fever in his whole life. The virus comes and goes. He said, I can't touch the vice chancellor, now the president of AIU. That's where I think we need to think about the importance of food and the focus on our agriculture in India. I leave you with these kind of radical thoughts. Go cracking, you have about, in my opinion, about 7 to 8 minutes. Do justice. Let my vice chancellor go back and implement some of your ideas. If they don't have agriculture as a discipline, let them at least open out with Bachelor of Food Technology or Food Processing and supplement your effort of creating food security for my country. Thank you, sir. Dr. Tripathi, please.
Good afternoon to all of you. Respected Professor P.V. Sharma, President of Association of Indian Universities, and respected Professor Sancheti, Vice President of Indian Universities Association, dignitaries on dais, Honorable Vice Chancellors, officers of the university, delegates, ladies and gentlemen, at the outset, on behalf of Indian Council of Agriculture Research and my own behalf, I am very thankful that Association of Indian Universities has invited Indian Council of Agriculture Research in this Augustus meeting. I would not take much time on such kind of things. But in brief, because agriculture and agriculture education is somewhat not a core subject in Indian universities, because I am working in Indian Council of Agriculture Research in the Division of Agricultural Education, and we are dealing with the accreditation system of agricultural universities, institutes. So we have basic knowledge that the perception of general education in Indian universities, general universities, is different for agricultural education. So first of all, I would like to have some brief thinking about what is agricultural education. Sir, this agricultural education in this country is being imparted through at this moment of time, 75 agricultural universities. Most of them are in the government sector. Till now, there is no exclusive agricultural university in private sector. As though there are many universities having a College of Agriculture and isolated degree programs in agriculture and related disciplines, but most of the 75 universities, almost all are in government sector. And they are imparting agricultural education through 11 undergraduate programs, almost 90 postgraduate programs, and more than 40 postdoctoral programs. And recently there was a cabinet decision that they have also started postdoctorate program, PD program. So to streamline all these programs, Indian Council of Agriculture Research in New Delhi is an apex body that is coordinating, determining the standards of education in agricultural institutes. For your kind discussion, I would tell that we have a Dean's Committee constituted long back in 1966. Till date, we have revised our UG course curricula 5 times. And this revision of course curricula is very unique. This is revision is done by the deans of the respective colleges, then this curricula is approved by ICAR and being implemented by agricultural universities, including some of the four deemed universities under ICAR system like IARI, IVRI, National Dairy Research Institute and CIFE Mumbai. There are four deemed universities in ICAR system, and rest of the 71 universities are under the state government. Recently, to strengthen the education system, Indian Council of Agriculture Research and Government of India has declared agriculture education as a professional education. Till now, agriculture education was a general education. Now they have declared as a professional education. And we are requesting many bodies like central sector schemes. Recently, in the Insecticide Act, our UG degree was made compulsory to have a dealership for the insecticide users, means sellers. So that is a landmark decision. So in ICAR, we are trying to promote education and also trying to build a system wherein our graduates and postgraduates can build their career. One more thing, we have 11 graduate systems, so there is one Veterinary Council of India. And this Veterinary Council of India is taking care of veterinary education for UG, and this PG program of veterinary sciences with ICAR till now. Sir, only education through the course curricula like Dean's Committee and BSMA Committee constituted by ICAR is not sufficient. ICAR thinks that unless we have something for the governance of the colleges and universities, that will not solve the purpose. Merely imposing the course curricula, that will not take care of, unless you have a strong monitoring mechanism through the deans of the colleges. So we have devised a minimum standards, recently approved by our agriculture minister, Honorable Agriculture Minister, Government of India, and have been instituted by all agricultural universities in 2017-2018 academic session. Another thing is that the governance, we have proposed a Model Act of Indian Council of Agriculture Research for agricultural universities, and now we are going to enhance the domain of this Model Act to the private institutions, because agriculture education is also under the private system. Many private colleges are there, and you know, there is a they don't have any control. They can increase n number of seats without any faculty, without any infrastructure. So we are trying to bring them also in the net through certain mechanism, and that is the revision of our Model Act, so that they can also be feeling responsible for that. We have been requesting UGC and other bodies, whenever they give the permission to open colleges and degree program in private sector and in also in the general universities, they have at least one representative from ICAR side, so that our own agenda like minimum standards, Model Act, course curricula to be taken care of. Otherwise, a sizable percentage of the students in agriculture, they are coming from private sector. And really, their quality is a matter of concern. They don't know ABCD of the system. They're simply coming with the theoretical knowledge. Sometimes theoretical knowledge is also a different kind of thing. Absolutely lacking in practical skills. So we are trying to develop a mechanism. Another thing is that in the fourth year of our graduation program, that is a new concept that was in the place, but it was more strengthened during this present Government of India regime. It was an initiative of Prime Minister Office, that student ready program. In the fourth year of the bachelor degree program, exclusively the students have to impart skills. We have sanctioned almost 450 experiential learning units. These units, students in the after completing third year, they are enrolled in experiential learning units. These units are running in a business mode. So from the beginning up to the marketability of the product, they learn each and everything in that sector. Afterwards, next 6 months, they are placed in the villages with the farmers. And they interact for 6 months with the farmers. They prepare a project report. There is a well-led mechanism for monitoring and evaluation on day-to-day basis. So after completion of these two programs, 6 month RAVE and 6 month ELP, and also in some of the agricultural engineering subjects, there is a industrial kind of training. So all these three things in 1 year, they complete. And when there is a satisfactory report, then they are eligible for getting a degree. So I would request Honorable Vice Chancellors in General Education that you please come out with such kind of ideas so that students can also feel responsible for their stakeholders. They should know for what they are getting education, to whom they are going to benefit. Otherwise, simply coming to the class, having a degree, passing out, and then making their own career of their own discretion, I think that will not solve the purpose. So we have to be a bit professional also. Sir, one more thing. We have a central sector scheme for strengthening and development of agricultural education in the country. That central sector scheme having a layout of about more than 500 crore per year, that is supporting faculty of the universities, students of the universities with a different kind of scholarship, fellowship, awards, and many more things, because that is a different subject. And if you want, I can explain personally. And sir, one good decision from the cabinet recently in 2015, that our central sector scheme was linked with the accreditation of agricultural university from Indian Council of Agricultural Research. So we have revised our accreditation system, and our accreditation system is unique in the country, unique in sense, because we have two main accreditation bodies, NBA for technical education and NAC for general university accreditation. One thing I would like to place before you, that in NBA, the program accreditation is the main theme. They focus on program, degree program, but have very little focus on administration side. In NAC, they have focus on administration, but when you go to their pro forma, the program accreditation is really lacking the focus. But in our accreditation system, that is unique. We bring our accreditation criteria from the program. If the programs are eligible, we go for the colleges, then to the university. Because our degree is professional, we feel that each and every program in the agricultural university system, in higher agricultural education system, is much more important.
Very important. Very good. Now we ask you some simple questions, yeah, and some tough questions.
Yeah.
The simple question is that agriculture is not the main discipline in our normal university. What can I add on in my general university in India from your agriculture university? Because everyone requires food. Everyone required to be happy and healthy. Yeah. What do I need to add which is currently missing in my general university education to serve that cause? Anything you could kindly tell us?
Yes, sir. Sir, one... No, no, sir, he is my mentor, everything. I am honored if he is here, sir. I am very much support. Sir, koi baat nahi. Sir, I am feeling comfortable. Sir, I am telling you that the one main important thing is that entire education in the country is in the concurrent list. Concurrent list means government of India and state governments, they can make guidelines to strengthen the education system. But the very unfortunate part with the agricultural education is that is the entirely state subject. So on behalf of ICR, I would request
Association of Indian Universities and especially to the president of association, please do something and bring agricultural education along with you so that we can also have some say like that.
Very good.
That is one of my requests.
Any questions from the audience here?
University, we cannot run these degrees. We cannot, you know, have BSc AG or MSc AG or MFSc. We cannot give. All right. So the idea is that, you know, we try to give start something at our university with a lot of objections we had from ICAR as to how are you starting, the large complaint with the UGC also, how a fisheries course can be started by Berkutalay University and ICAR course. But then UGC was with us and we started the course and gave MFSc. A lot of resistance, a lot of protests were there from ICR. And although we have very good infrastructure at Berkutalay University, Dr. Sharma also knows, he has been coming to the university also when he was there. Idea that we cannot run these agriculture degrees and fisheries related degrees in the state-owned universities. And supposing as a part of the BSc or MSc degree in the life science, if we introduce as one of the papers, that doesn't serve the purpose also. The problem is, these degrees, unless you allow us also to run these degrees in the state-owned universities, it will not just address the problem. We cannot have more graduates and postgraduate students. This is one thing. Another thing, and Dr. Sharma raised a couple of questions in the beginning as to how are you going to address those water-related problems and the drought problems, etc. Most of the graduates and postgraduates, they seek their career between scientists and the lecturers and professors in the university. Mm-hmm. And less of them, very few of them becomes entrepreneurs in agriculture sector. So it doesn't address the problems, you know.
Okay.
Unless you train the farmers also equally well.
Okay, thank you, sir. Thank you. Very appropriate question. Because we are facing a lot of issues in council. First of all, sir, I would say that ICR never says to any university that you go or don't go for agricultural courses. Sir, if the university is established under the State Act, they are eligible for running all agricultural programs, including 11 UG, 90 PG, and other things. ICR only infuses only the minimum standards. Minimum standards means what, sir? If you are going for a BSc AG program, we have a criteria that for practical point of view and other things, you should have minimum land, cultivable land with good irrigation system, so that you can impart practical skills to the students. There are certain set of laboratories required for imparting education, BSc AG education, BBSc education, all 11 disciplines. So only if you are able to meet the criteria, I don't think ICR is going to deter you for any kind of thing. Sir, I'm taking example. You go to Gorakhpur University in UP. Gorakhpur University in UP. All stalwarts in agriculture education, research and extension system nowadays, like Dr. Punjab Singh, Dr. Kirti Singh, they are all from the general universities. So it is not that ICR is telling that only agriculture universities can open the agriculture college. Sir, you can also open, you can give a proposal to the state government. If you get the necessary statutory permission from them, you can open it. And if you will send a proposal to ICR, ICR will only say yes. And only will write only this line that you ensure please the minimum standard. Nothing else than that. Yeah. And sir, one more part is lacking, sir, I think.
Sir, if chairman permits me, I want to ask a very simple clarification, sir.
Sir.
I am Professor Rajasa from Rai Technology University, Karnataka,
okay,
which is situated near Bangalore. It is a state private university and we are importing BSc AG at present. Fourth year students are coming in June 2018.
Okay,
we have a small problem. Maybe other universities also are facing this problem. With regard to ICR, when our students pass their BSc AG, they are eligible to take postgraduate entrance exam, for which ICR has given their advertisement that the students from many recognized universities are eligible, for which I am thankful to you.
Yeah.
But the same situation is not there in Tamil Nadu, Andhra Pradesh, and Karnataka is yet to take the decision. Telangana is favorable, it is good. Advertisement is perfectly okay. So in different states, different situation is existing for the students who are coming out from the general universities who are taking their degree in BSc AG, for which ICAR has, we have submitted self-appraisal report and all the things. UGC has visited and it has given a review report, everything. So can you, from ICAR, direct the states, different states, to recognize the students coming out of these private universities to make them eligible to take entrance exam of any university which is conducting PG entrance exam for agriculture?
Okay, thank you, sir.
Thank you.
We are well aware of this issue, sir. And it is not only the Rai University, Rai Technical University, but many more universities like LPU in Punjab and others are also raising the same issues. Sir, recently ICAR has issued a public notice that once the university has been established by the State Act, the candidates or students passing out from that university are eligible in any of the entrance examination conducted by agricultural universities. And repeatedly we are telling them that, yes, if you want to curtail these students, they should not come to your entrance examination, something like that. You please modify your criteria of selection. But generally, on the general perception, you cannot say that the students from this university can be debarred from higher education, for the higher education. So we are taking care of, sir. We are repeatedly writing them, sending them the public notice, personal communications, everything. But you know that state agricultural universities are autonomous bodies under the state government. They have a different agenda because you know that agricultural education was the domain of a, you can say, confinement for few people. Suppose in a state, this is a public forum, I'm telling this, in a state, there are 1,000 students of BSc AG program from the agricultural universities. Till now, they were thinking that entire job sector, entire higher education sector was only available for them. But their mindset is not that. Another partners have also come in the fray. So they have to change their mindset, particularly for the universities. So you keep on telling them, sir, we also tell up from our side, it will be done.
Dr. Tripathi.
Yeah, we have issued a public notice, sir. That is all.
Dr. Tripathi.
Yes, sir.
I am a former Vice Chancellor of Agriculture University, HV Krishna Vidyalaya, Palampur.
Oh, thank you, sir.
And now we have a university, Shunli University of Biotechnology and Management Sciences. There we intend starting BSc Agriculture and it has been approved by the government, subject to the condition that you fulfill the criteria of the Dean's Committee report.
Yeah, yeah.
But when I look at the Dean's Committee report, you have 42 acres of land for starting BSc Agriculture.
Yeah.
You do not classify there whether this land is required for setting up the university or a course, 42 acres of land. I personally feel it is too huge a demand. You do not require that much land. That for students giving practicals, you need such a huge tract of land. And then if you take the land on, this land is not available. Land is very expensive these days. If you take on lease, then it is written 30 years of lease. No farmer is willing. They can maximum give two for 10 years. Many farmers are now abandoning agriculture. That is a national threat. That farmers, sons, new younger generation, they want to have small jobs or daily paid workers rather than to going on the field. The large tract of the lands are available, but nobody is willing for 30 acres. Could the ICAR think of reducing the period of the lease at least?
Thank you, sir. Thank you. I got your
point.
So
should I contact you?
Sir.
In Delhi?
Yeah, yes, sir.
Okay, definitely, I will meet you. Oh, thank you,
sir.
Very much.
I'm telling you, sir. Sir, let me clarify you, sir. You, as a former vice chancellor, you are well aware of the issues. Earlier, all the state agricultural universities were set up on the pattern of land grant system. Land grant system means during the course of education, imparting education, you have to generate your own resources through the lands available with you. The now the concept is a bit changing day by day. Now the system is that they are going for the self-finance mode Other things are that you have different mode of source of income for the university. So, sir, recently ICAR, National Agriculture Education Accreditation Board, under the chairmanship of our secretary and DG ICAR, they have taken a decision. They are going to revise their minimum standards as per the agroecological zones. Certainly, your issue is pertinent, sir. In the hills area, if you will ask for 50 acre of land or something, 500 hectare of land for a university, that is not pertinent. Hello, so the committee has already been constituted under Dr. S.S. Chahal's chairmanship. There are many vice chancellors also from one general university. There is one vice chancellor, Dr. N.C. Gautam from Chitrakoot.
Thank you.
So
thank you, thank
everything you. Is being taken care of, sir. Very soon we are going to publish a report and that will take care of it.
Fellow vice chancellors, I have four more apex body representatives with me. If we continue, I can see there are a lot of problems why we don't have agriculture as a discipline in the normal universities. Sir has flagged certain issues. Yeah. Let the dialogue continue hereafter. I would have been more happy if you would have said that introduce a subject like food quality or food safety as an additional subject in all disciplines in our country. Then I would have been at least able to serve some cause of food security, food safety, food reliability and all that. But in any case, separate agriculture discipline in a university requires a lot more thinking, a lot more dialogue. We'll continue after the presentation.
Thank you, sir.
If you permit, we move to the other apex bodies and then have some fun. But since you have come forward, aap pooch lijiye zara jaldi se ek sawal.
Sir, main Rajasthan se hoon. Aur Rajasthan government ne ek apna letter issue kiya hai abhi. Ki agle academic session ke liye. कि उन्होंने सिक्स प्राइवेट यूनिवर्सिटीज़ के लिए सीट फिक्स कर दिए, दैट इज़ 120, ओके. और साथ में एक डायरेक्शन भी दिया है कि अगर हमारी यूनिवर्सिटी को दो साल पहले परमिशन मिल चुकी थी एग्रीकल्चर डिपार्टमेंट स्टार्ट करने की, वी हैव रनिंग सेकेंड ईयर, ओके. नाउ वन ऑफ द कंडीशन इज़ दैट कि पिछले सालों में अगर आपने 120 से ज़्यादा बच्चों को एडमिट कर लिया है तो उनकी फीस का 50% यू हैव टू डिपॉजिट विद द गवर्नमेंट. How this possible?
Yes, sir. That is actually ICAR need not to interfere in such kind of thing because this is the administrative decision between state government because you are established by the state government.
No,
so you have to comply with their rules, regulations, everything. So I would advise on behalf of ICAR to please pursue the state government. This is not a right thing for the agricultural education. So any such kind of guideline or directive from the state government, which is not in favor of developing the agriculture education in private sector. Sir, please, you represent, and if you can call ICAR, ICAR can also be party along with you. They can also...
ICAR can give a direction to the state government.
Let the dialogue continue beyond this, but sir, Dr. Ramachandran has served the cause of agriculture in his university without bothering about ICAR. So tell us, how could it be done quickly? Can every campus have its own food and its own energy and its own water and whatnot?
Okay. Thank you, Mr. President. I am Ramachandran, Vice Chancellor, Sandeep University, Nasik, Maharashtra. Previously, I was serving 10 years Vice Chancellor in Tamil Nadu. Of course, our President visited and Dr. Kalam visited 6 times to my campus. A lot of work we have been doing even today. See, now the question to Dr. Tripathi, in line with our theme, that entrepreneurship. Very rightly, Mr. President has put a question, but you have not come to that subject. You know, the suicidal attempt of farmers in the country is very alarming, right? As custodians of higher education, what kind of efforts we should take? This is very important, number one. And more to say, ICAR should concentrate producing as many as model entrepreneurs as a farmer. See, I happen to be a civil engineer. I can be a civil engineer. I am doing building construction. My engineering students are doing like that. My mechanical engineering students, they are starting their own company. Tell me, through your ICAR and intervention of your curricula, how many BSc agriculture graduates or MSc graduates turn to be a model farmer? In this country, this question I was repeatedly asking with many of my brothers and sisters vice chancellor, there was no answer so far. They simply, of course, they go to IAS, no doubt. They serve as a secretary agriculture, no doubt. That is all fine. My job is, my question is very simple. Your curricula should encourage persons even without holding land can be given such an amount and even land to develop a model farms.
Thank you.
This is what is required for the immediate future.
Point is well taken, but
yes,
I would not put Dr. Tripathi in a corner here because the opportunities are great in this sector, and I'm pretty sure in the years to come, you would see a tremendous boom in respect of agriculture promoted enterprises, food
Mr.
processing
Chairman,
enterprises.
My submission to the chair is this. At least ICAR can encourage the students of BSc Agri or MS Agri who is not having enough money, enough land to become an entrepreneur. Whenever I used to ask some agri graduates, they are working as like a technical assistant in a farming activities. Whereas, why don't you start yourself? No, sir, I have no land. Sir, I have no money. Why not ICAR to initiate maybe 10 acres? Whosoever wants to start as a 10 acres with the money?
The point is well flagged.
Yes, sir.
Dr. Tripathi, sir, take it to Delhi when you go back.
Yeah, definitely, sir. Right. But sir,
thank you.
Because this is apex body, one thing I would like to request you, sir, and place before you, sir. In entire world, I'm telling from Australia to America, not a single graduate wants to pursue the farming. That is the unfortunate part, sir. It is not only in India. There are many outstanding students, very hardworking students. They can do the wonder in the field, but for the sake of white collar job, they don't want to go to the agriculture. That is the crux of the matter.
So the problem is global, not just national.
Yeah.
Dr. Ramachandran, we'll find local as well as global solutions for this. But let's move on, because really speaking, I will be branded as one of the most successful session chair otherwise, because four more speakers are to be given with due respect their time. Dr. Tripathi, thank you very much indeed.
Thank you so much. Thank you.
The next speaker comes from Indian Council of Historical Research. And history is very important for a nation like ours. We want to go as back as our eyes can permit us to go to the antiquity and come back to the modern time and discover the value and worth of historical research for creating a bright future. So Dr. Shukla, you have an opportunity to inspire my fellow vice chancellors how to utilize the historical research for creating a better tomorrow for us here in India.
Honorable Chairman, sir, dignitaries on dais, vice chancellors, stalwart academicians of nation and from abroad. Firstly, I want to make a very little bit submission. I am working as a member secretary of ICPR and ICHR, both the councils, and I'm representing both the councils. This is not a, though this is an coincident, but I think the history and philosophy goes together. The basic problem, which was widely discussed in this presidential address by Honorable Chairman, the objective of the education. We are copying the education system, especially the British education system. And as so far the history says, the India was the laboratory for our Britishers to evolve the pseudo professional technical education in India. While they were continuing their grammar schools in their country, they started a polytechnic in India. That was the first polytechnic. Another thing, in whole Indian education system, philosophy of education is neglected. Indigenous philosophy of education system is neglected. The mindset of the educationist and the faculty members of Indian universities undoubtedly colonial mindset, though we used to say that is a continental mindset. So, for philosophy, Indian Council of Philosophical Research has established we have to go for decolonization of the mindset through the philosophizing education system. This is a thought area. And for last 2-3 years, ICPR is trying to start a discussion among the stakeholders of education, what should be and what ought to be the philosophy of education, objective of education, and sometimes pedagogy of education also for the Indian universities. We are having a national university for higher education, but pedagogy of higher education is still undiscussed, unexplored, and even unmentioned anywhere. This is the first thing. What should be the pedagogy of the higher education, especially in the field of the social sciences and humanities? This question is a very big question. We are doing for this, sir. Again, in history, as the member secretary of the ICHR, I have a question with the vice chancellors. Ours is the only nation where history is regimentalized between the periods of the history. Ancient history, modern history, medieval history. We are the only nation, only country, only cultural group. And it has been not done by any apex body or the government. This was evolved through the universities where humanities, faculties, humanity education is going on. And when we regimentalize our history, we regimentalize our past. History is the only subject, philosophy is the only thought process which is essential, basic foundation of all disciplines of knowledge. A regimentalized discipline of history cannot serve the objective of history. Objective of history is not only knowing what was happened in the past, what were the incidents of the past, but history of education, history education is a way to evaluate, criticize, and set the goal for future in the knowledge. And so far the theme of this conference is concerned, the two things are very important: innovation, entrepreneurship. Innovation is not possible without a philosophical outlook and a historical background. But it's true, these two disciplines of the humanities are deteriorating day by day. Our council is a PAX council of history and philosophy, but we cannot pass sanctions like
ICAR. We cannot create rules, we cannot frame rules, and we cannot able to direct any educational institution in a binding manner, but we are only suggestive institutions. So we can set a goal, and Indian Council of Historical Research, Indian Council of Philosophical Research, both have some common programs, promotion of the research in the field of history, promotion of research at the doctorate level, and we provide a good number of the fellowships. But day by day, the aspirants are decreasing. We are providing research project grants to the faculties. And again, I'm saying, though the proposals are not decreasing, but quality of the proposals are day by day decreasing. So here I am not to inform you something new, what is going in the arena of the history and philosophy, new, but here I am to request you, if history and philosophy is neglected in higher education, we cannot achieve the goal of the education. The philosophy department should be the powerhouse of the higher education. And the reality of the higher education is philosophy departments are going closed down day by day. Today, in whole Tamil Nadu, we are having only one philosophy department in the one state university. Either departments are changed into philosophy of Saiva Siddhanta or closed. The department of philosophy is very rare in the private universities. Department of humanities, which were the basically department of history and philosophy, or sometimes the sociology in the NITs, IITs, and so many technical universities, that all are going closed down. I am directed to some of me. So this is the basic question. Entrepreneurship cannot be immersed without creative ability, without creating creative imagination in the young generation. And creative imagination cannot be created, cannot be evolved without the knowing the past, without knowing the gradual development of the mankind with its cultural and social mooring, and the objective of the mankind, objective of a cultural group, objective of the cultural society and nation. Thank you. Both are related with the philosophy. The both disciplines are in great threat. I am requesting you, please consider how to rejuvenate these disciplines. With this, I am
completing you, Dr. Sikla. We are with you to rejuvenate Department of History and Department of Psychology. But we would like you to talk more about modern tools and techniques to dig out the history of science, history of technology, history of architecture. अभी नहीं उसके बाद मैं आपको सवाल आगे के लिए दे रहा हूँ. History of agriculture as a science here in our country. government is already thinking of rewriting the history of India, and we need to have scientific tools and systems in place to do that. You can generate a whole lot of entrepreneurship in this, and that's where your role to facilitate the university to march in this direction really lies. We will take some questions at the end, but let's move on now to the next one. The next one is very important. Central Depository Services, part of Digital India Mission. I'm sure all my vice chancellors must be present when Digital India Mission was rolled out by the Honorable Prime Minister in the presence of Honorable President of India at that time. And I have with me Mr. Amit Jain from Central Depository Scheme. Please tell us how we can go ahead and strengthen your resolve to digitize education and education system in totality.
A very good afternoon to all of you. I'm going to share about new ideas of new initiative of government, which government has recently taken in the field of education. As all of you are aware that government of India is committed to bring administrative reforms in various fields. Similarly, in the field of education, they have established a national academic depository where all the academic awards of any student may be stored, may be issued and stored digitally. So under Digital India, this concept, I'm sure this concept is definitely going to change our lives, because as of now, we are facing lots of issues, lots of problems at university level, at academic institution level, related to physical certificates. I start my presentation with an introduction of CDSL, why CDSL has been chosen to establish this project. CDSL core business is into the security depository. We have founded in 1998, and as of now we are maintaining more than 20 lakhs crores of securities for more than 1.5 crore investors, and we are handling large volume of transactions per day. So seeing this volume, government has chosen CDSL to depositories to set up this national academic depository, a depository in the field of education also. Then why a depository for academic awards is required? What kind of problems we are facing in physical certificate? As all of you are aware, today all the academic institutions are on a big reputational risk. Something happens, some student managed to get the fake degree, forged degrees. So there's a reputational risk to academic institution. To overcome these kind of issues, also a university or academic institution need to maintain a separate department for verification purpose, and that verification process is very cumbersome. It's very time consuming. Sometimes students lose the job because of verification is not being done on the time. So that's why an initiative has been taken by the government that all the academic awards may be stored in a central server. That central server may be that at any time, anywhere, that central server may be accessed by the verifiers, by the students, by the academic institution to get the degrees. That the role of NAD will be preservation of physical records. Obviously, it will be quite cheaper, because over a period of time, maybe after 5 years or 7 years, the physical printing of degrees may be eliminated, because as of now, all the university, all the academic institutions are incurring a huge cost towards physical degree printing. So it would be beneficial for institutions also. Obviously, if I, as an academic institution, want to withdraw a degree which was issued, say, 20 years prior, so it's a difficult job. It's a cumbersome process. So that process will be quite easy, because degrees, all the awards will be stored in a digital repository forever. What happened in this digital depository till date? We are working on this project since last 4-5 years. The project is ready, and this project was formally launched by Honorable President of India in the presence of Education Minister Sri Prakash Javadekar ji on 9 July 2017. And they have requested all the institutes to join this initiative But as of now, this initiate, this joining this, the NAD system is not mandatory from government, but they have requested to join this initiative by all AIs. The stakeholders who will run this depository system, the stakeholders of the depository systems are obviously academic institution, because all the awards will be given by academic institution only. Students have very limited rights just to access the awards. The awards will be given in the digital depository by academic institution, by university digital sign awards. And that's why that fake and false awards will be eliminated from the system. The second thing is fake universities. Time to time, UGC gives a list of fake universities. And sometimes students are not aware that this university is not recognized by UGC. So that all the fake universities will also get eliminated from this system. The second stakeholder, obviously students. Students will have an access to this system anytime, anywhere. And the... pardon, sir? As a fake, because before boarding an university, we will be verifying it from UGC, whether that university is recognized by UGC or not. We will be verifying the status from UGC or MHRD. Third stakeholder will be the verifiers. Obviously, an student is getting a degree, they will go for a job. And verification, as of now, there's very less verification in the country because of cumbersome process of verification. If the awards are digitally available, it may be verified by any verifier 24/7, because the system is going to be available 24/7. Some benefits I have tried to find out. Now, as an institution, what I need to do, what need to be taken care by an academic institution. The process is very simple for academic institution, and this service is absolutely free of cost for AIs. AI need not to pay a single rupees for joining this NAD facility. Just an agreement, they said this is a standard agreement given by MHRD and UGC. Just an agreement need to be signed with the depository, and depository will give a UAT platform, a testing platform initially. Once your team is comfortable with the testing system, we will make you live. We will give you a live access where you will be, where your team will be required to upload the academic awards, digitally signed academic awards. So joining process is very simple, just an agreement need to be signed. Some benefits I have tried to figure out, the benefits of digital depository, the process. Yes, sir.
Rather than telling the benefit, if you could inform to our member universities that what is the problem that you have from the universities then,
yeah,
so that they could focus
on. Okay, it. I'll take care.
Better you take few questions.
Yeah. Some problems when we discuss with the deposit, when we discuss with the universities, some problem which is being given by universities are they don't have any staff for uploading the academic awards on the NAD system, the technical staff and all. Sometimes they say that they need additional systems for making academic awards and all, other things. So the process, we have tried to make the process very simple, that you don't need to appoint an additional staff, you don't need to take the additional systems for joining an academic depository. Our team is going to help you to establish your systems, because I think all the universities are maintaining a back office software at their level. So once you join this initiative, there's a single one time job your technical official will be doing, just feeding the file formats in the system, just getting the output as per the required file format. Once the programming is done, you need to take the file from your system, or an API may be developed where the system of depository and system of university will talk together. Once you have issued the awards, so you just need to, your official need to click a button, awards will be uploaded on the academic depository automatically. You don't need to give a scan copy of academic awards which you have given to students and all. There is an misconception in the universities that I need to scan all the academic awards, all the degrees which I have given to students and upload it to the digital depository system. No, it is not there. You just need to give in a one format to us, to the depository, that this is my degree format. And once that format is filled in my system, once I have filled the format in my system, every year just you need to give the data in the specified file format, just digitally signed data. Why I am asking for the digitally signed data? Because when the data is communicating from your server to my server, there's no chance for hacking of the data, or there's something cannot be happen to that data. That's why we are asking for the digitally signed data. And you are the issuer, obviously you are the issuer of the document. So your sign should be there. So that's why we are asking for the digital signed data. So process, we have tried to make it very simple. We have given our brochure where all the numbers of our regional office, we have 13 offices across country. Our offices of our officer mobile's number is given in the brochure. So you can call anytime, you can call our officers. Our officers will sit with your IT team. They will guide your IT team how to make the file available to the depository system. Obviously, once the programming is done, the system will be quite easy. Initially, at least you can do the testing. And maybe in the short time, the government make this project mandatory, because government want to do all the academic awards digital as soon as possible.
Mr. Jain, we cannot afford to fail in this initiative.
Yeah.
It would be important for you to convince the government to do hand-holding and also to incentivize university joining you so that it becomes a success story.
I have prepared one small video of 1 minute which will be giving a concept of NAD, why this NAD is there and what benefits will be there. So I think I should play this video. Yeah, please sir.
Take the questions.
Now there are two agencies identified by the UGC. Yes, sir.
In addition to that, the Government of India has the
DigiLocker. Yes, sir.
So how do you compare?
Obviously.
Yeah, I mean, there are now three systems.
Yes, sir.
DigiLocker, there are two agencies identified by the UGC.
Yes, sir.
Will all the data go to a central depository, or in the case of DigiLocker, as I understand,
yes, sir,
the data resides in the university websites, in the university service.
Number.
I mean, whereas you have designed a different, altogether a different system for transfer of data from the university to this one. So as a stakeholder, otherwise to verify it, how do I access these three different sets of people?
First of all, it's very technical.
I mean, you will have to answer this technically, because
as
a user also, you have to understand how do I get into the three ones.
Okay. The first thing is what the difference between the digital depository and the digital locker. The digital locker is a facility given by Government of India. The Ministry of IT is running the digital locker system, where digital locker may be operated in two modes. One mode is I as a citizen of India have created a digital locker. I have scanned all my documents, have uploaded to the digital locker, and the documents is available to me anytime, anywhere. But in this case, the genuinity of the document may not be there, because I have only scanned the documents and uploaded on the digital locker. The second mode of operating the digital locker is you as an issuer of the document has connected to digital locker system. You have uploaded the documents for the student. You have uploaded the documents. But in that case, a document is not actually uploaded on the digital locker. A link is being uploaded on the digital locker. As and when a student is accessed or a verifier access that document, system will route to your server, and your data will be fetched from your server, will shown to the verifier. In that case, your server should be on 24/7, because I may access my document at any time. While in case of digital depository, the data will be there in my system. It will be digitally signed data, digitally signed by university authorized official. It will lie on my server. And digital locker will be for any document. It may be for driving license, it may be for PAN card, it may be for passport, it may be for academic awards. But digital depository for academic awards will be only for the purpose of academic reason. Academic awards only will be there in the digital depository. Verification. Now, Second thing is the monitoring. In case of digital locker, if a verification is being taken place, you as a university may be charging some fees for verification, say 1,000 rupees or 2,000 rupees maybe. But if a verification is being taken place through digital locker, you will not be getting that fees. But in case a verification is being done through depository system, you will get your fees, because we will be charging the fees you are charging from the verifiers. We will charge that fees from the verifier. We will pass on the fees to university. That's a monitored thing. And obviously, once the data is uploaded on the digital depository, on the academic depository, you don't need to maintain your servers. The data will, I will take care of about the system, about the database. And
may I ask a question, sir?
The other part is two depositories. As on date, there are two depositories in India who are maintaining securities business. So you are free to choose any one of two depositories, but both the depositories are interconnected. Once you have uploaded the data on one depository, it will be available to other also.
Hello.
Because as a university, you have signed up with me, but your student has enrolled on the depository. So student should be able to access that data. So both the depositories are interoperable.
Good afternoon, friends. Sorry for this intervention. We are already late.
Sir, I have to ask. Please permit me just for 1 minute.
Yeah, please.
Because it is important for our, you know.
Sir, keep it very, very small. Yeah, otherwise, he is available. We'll request all the experts to be available to share their answers.
Let others know the problems. Ever since the education minister announced NAD in Vignan Bhavan, it started. And we have been doing it.
Yes, sir.
Last 1 year.
Okay, sir.
Now, my question to you is whether you are permitted by UGC or by MHRD.
Yeah. Yes, sir.
No. You just answer me. Mm-hmm. Whether you are permitted to have these documents by UGC or MHRD.
Okay.
Sir. You tell me.
This is an initiative of MHRD, but MHRD has appointed UGC as a nodal agency to implement this project.
Okay.
And UGC has signed an agreement.
When someone else does the verification, say from a foreign country,
yes, sir.
How much fees you charge?
Sir, whatever your fees is there, we will charge your fees plus my fees. My fees is available on our website, which is approved by UGC.
Okay. What is your data? How much you have done?
Sir, as of now, both the depository have more than 92 lakhs of records in the depository system.
University-wise income?
Yeah. As of now, because this project is absolutely free for 2 years. It has been kept free for universities. So as of now, we are just running this project. Maybe after 2 years, if UGC or MHRD is permitters, so maybe we may get some charge.
Okay, we'll have the rest of the information shared directly. Yeah. Friends, we are running short of time, and we are also encroaching on the other session's time. It also happens that one of our experts, who is for the next session, that is Professor Francesco Marmelojo from the World Bank, has to leave. He has a flight to catch. So we are making a small change in the session in terms of speakers. Can I request Professor Francesco to kindly come on the dais and also join us and also make his presentation? We'll again limit you to as minimum as required in the context of time. Please. You can directly take the... I must tell you before he starts that the TechCube is one of the very successful programs of Government of India that is called Technical Educational Quality Improvement Program, which is being driven by the World Bank and Professor Francesco and his team in India. And this is the third version, and they have very successfully done both in terms of financial uses as well as its implementational goals. And that's why they have also located their office in the country now, because India being a very high growth sector for them, And we are very happy that a leader of His Eminence is available to us here right in Delhi.
Thank you very much. And I truly apologize for this change in the program. Unfortunately, I have a flight to catch because I'm flying to the US later tonight, and there is the only connection that I have. Again, my apologies, and I will try to be as brief as possible. You know, originally I was planning to talk a little bit about the fact that globally higher education is experiencing very interesting trends. It's a sector that is increasingly complex. It is also a sector that is expected to grow a lot. It is under a lot of pressure, but also is a sector that societies are demanding significant changes. The World Bank conducts every year a study globally to understand what are the key challenges, the key trends that are important for governments in the world. And look at the three most important ones that globally are being seen as the important ones. Quality assurance and governance, employability of graduates, financing, and then other aspects. So it is interesting to see that challenges being faced in India are very similar to the ones that are seen in other parts of the world. We know that a lot of people are having access to higher education. Look at this trend, how much growth in higher education has happened. And I'd like to pay, for you to pay attention to the comparative case of China and India. Look at China. In the year 2020, China will experience the peak in higher education enrollment, but then it's going to start to decline just because of the demographic trends. While in the case of India, 2020 will be precisely the time in which higher education will have to start jumping up in such a manner that higher education will be, again, a significant factor for development of India in the future years. In recent years, growth has been dramatic, and all of you should be commended for that. Just in comparative analysis, India has growth, while the world has experienced a growth of about 50% of its enrollment. In the case of India, that growth has been more than 100%. In fact, as of today, out of 100 students in higher education globally, 14 are the students of your higher education institutions. As of now, India has the second largest system of higher education in the world, but very soon it's going to be the largest system of higher education in the world. So what that means, among other things, that the stock of professionals in the world, the proportion of stock of professionals from India is going to go from about 15% to almost 23% in the year 2030. So the students of today in your higher education institutions, the graduates of your higher education institutions will be that particular cadre of professionals that, unless they have something different, they will be more of the same. And of course, you have a significant challenge ahead. So the problem is that still there is significant disparity in access to higher education, especially among some sectors of our societies for which higher education continues being just an illusion, just a dream that cannot be fulfilled. You can see in this particular chart, for instance, the disparity between rich and poor people in access to higher education in India. And we know that by fact, that, you know, for people from the sectors of society underprivileged, access to higher education continues being a significant challenge. Now, the problem is not only access to higher education, it is also relevance of higher education. Because what students learn in our higher education institutions not always is what it is needed. Interestingly, the studies of the World Bank show that higher education is, as of today, the best investment that societies and individuals can make, as you can observe in this chart, in which the highest economic returns to education are precisely the returns of higher education in comparison to the previous levels of education. But again, it doesn't help if what students learn is not as relevant as it should be. This morning I mentioned about some of the skills, the gap that exists between the perception of employers about the performance of the graduates of higher education institutions. So, and on quality, there is one of the biggest challenges of higher education, because we know that accreditation, and this relates in a way to the session that it is being discussed right now, many times accreditation is kind of an act of compliance of institutions, an opportunity to feature an institution as a very good one. Many times to put a diploma in the office of the Vice Chancellor, saying that the institution is fully accredited, but not always is also what it should be, which is really a means towards a better relevance of the higher education institutions. Of course, the question is if we know that it's responding to that. And in this environment, unfortunately, today as well, there is the big challenge of the tyranny of the rankings, which are pushing many times the policies of governments, but also, of course, the policies of higher education institutions just for the sake of complying with the rankings. And we know that very well, that an institution hates and dislikes the rankings until the institution is in the rankings. And when you are in the rankings, then the institution is the first one celebrating that now we are in the rankings. But if we are not, we have many reasons to explain why we are not in the rankings. So there is an opportunity to transform the curriculum of the higher education institutions. There are significant trends globally that I will invite higher education institutions in India to explore, to use, to be upfront. Let's use the ingenuity and the capacity of innovation of India in making sure that it is a system that will be upfront in experiencing new ways to teach, recognizing that students now require new ways to learn in an environment that is going to be changing dramatically. Why don't we think about the fact that professions of the future will be completely different to the professions in which we are teaching students today? That is not happening. I like, all these professions, which, let's see this one, ethno-epidemiologist, musician. All of those are professions not of the future, believe it or not. All of those are professions of the present. And in the current circumstances, our higher education institutions sometimes keep teaching the traditional academic subjects without recognizing that the world will be completely different and will require new types of professions. So higher education have the tendency to resist the change. And we need to create environments that may connect better the teaching, the research, and the public services. And we know that governments have to act, but also higher education institutions need to embrace in this change. So who told us that higher education institutions cannot change? The ones criticizing our universities say that this was the Italian university in 1350, and that the universities of today continue being very similar, probably with some changes in the clothing or the technology or the PowerPoints, but still we are repeating the same traditional pattern. So the World Bank in India, briefly I'd like to mention to you, is the country that has the largest contribution in higher in education globally. As of today, about 20% of the total involvement of the World Bank in education at the global level is in India. And particularly in higher education, let me tell you briefly about two projects. I don't have too much time. One is about TechWIP, the Technical Education Quality Improvement Project. This is the oldest higher education program globally of the World Bank, and this is a project in India. It began in 2003. Professor Sanchetti knows that very well because he was involved in the conception of this program. And now it is in the third generation. It moved from central institutions to centrally sponsored scheme, and now it is a program that is focusing in low-income states, especially also in the Northeast, Hill States, and Islands. And the idea of the program is to take the experience of the good institutions, the well-developed institutions, and to use that to try to help the institutions that are still in the process of emerging in order to fast improve the quality of those institutions while benefiting also the well-developed institutions. So the program is basically a joint investment of the World Bank and the government of India through MHRD, and it has some components. The first one that has to do with improving quality and equity in engineering institutions in focus states. The second one that has to do with twinning arrangements between well-developed and developing institutions. And the third one, both, of course, between inside India. And the third one with a series of system-level initiatives which are aimed at strengthening the governance of the higher education sector in India. One of the components of the project, briefly I will mention to you, is a study that is being conducted with Stanford University, under which students from a variety of institutions, probably some of your institutions, are participating in a very long tracking analysis of what students learn and know when they enter into the higher education institution, in the middle of the academic program, and also at graduation. Something as simple as knowing what are the value added that the students are having in our institutions, sometimes we don't know, and the program precisely provides that information. As another example, briefly, I will mention the case of Orissa. In the state of Orissa, the government of Orissa, MHRD, and the bank came to put together a program which is comprehensive because it involves a majority of higher education institutions. Here it is represented, one of the higher education institutions that I visited recently, and I was very impressed in visiting those institutions in the region. So the objective of this program is to improve students' equitable access and quality in those institutions through enhanced government and management of higher education in Orissa. The program has basically several goals, which is intended to increase access to the least privileged to higher education. It is also intended to help institutions to obtain accreditation, and also is helping to connect better affiliated colleges with affiliating universities. A nice thing of this program is that also connects with the goals of RUSA in such a way that is complementing with other sources of support for higher education institutions. An interesting addition of this program is the creation of a higher education governance screen card, which intends to provide a good benchmarking to institutions in order for them to know how they are doing, not as a ranking, but as a benchmarking, in comparison with other institutions in the area of mission and goals, management, autonomy, accountability, and participation. Participating institutions will be able to compare how they are performing in comparison to other institutions, and also will be able to compare how they are doing now and how they will be doing in the future years. We have a similar program in MP, which I won't describe briefly, but I just would like to conclude by inviting all the universities and also IAU for us to come together in increasing our collaboration. The willingness of our organization is to work with institutions of higher education in India. I already had a very good conversation with the Secretary General of the Association in order to put together a collaborative program, which I hope is going to contribute also to the goals that all of you have in place. We know that higher education institutions that are needed in our world are institutions that need to be more international, but also more locally connected, more flexible, more innovative, more entrepreneur, less risk averse, and of course, more collaborative. And this is the invitation for all of us to collaborate. I know that we have great opportunities to collaborate, and of course, there are many ways to collaborate. You know, we can collaborate this way. I don't know if you like that type of collaboration. Or we can collaborate also this way, or even on this way, or even we can collaborate in matters that probably sometimes we don't pay too much attention. We know that everybody's contribution to a common goal is important. And that is my invitation. Since a year and a half ago, I've moved from Washington, D.C. to India, and I'm intended to be in India for another almost 2 years. And I hope that this is just not the last, but the first of the many opportunities that we can have to collaborate together in order to have more effective collaboration, more effective improvement of higher education in the country. So as Paul Valéry said many years ago, the trouble with our times is that the future is no longer that it used to be. I truly appreciate your time. I wish you a great success in the conference, and I thank you very much for the invitation and for the opportunity to participate in this event today. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Professor Francisco Marmolejo. Friends, he has to leave for the flight, and therefore he won't be available later for any questions and answers. So we allow two quick questions. Please keep them short if it's possible, because we're already running very late. Two quick questions to Professor Francisco, if there are any. No one wants the money, which we all seek. World Bank is ready to help us with that. Sir, they are little scared to seek money from you, maybe. Yes, sir.
Can you give us some clue about how World Bank can cooperate with the Indian higher academic scenario? How it can collaborate with the universities in India?
Yeah. Well, you know, of course, we are doing that right away. You know, these type of projects are projects that had been designed both with the central government, in this particular case, MHRD, but also with state governments, as it is the case of Orissa as well as MP. Now, there are a number of things that we can do together. The first one, of course, and this is the conversation that we have with Dr. Furkan, is let's work together in those type of analytical work that can be useful to support the agenda of the Association of Indian Universities. The nice, great thing that organizations such as the World Bank bring to the table is the opportunity to bring together practices. I wouldn't say best practices. I would say practices that happen in other higher education environments globally, and to see which of those practices may or may not be relevant to the case of India. So my invitation is to work together in putting together those policy documents that can be useful as the Association of Indian Universities is putting together a dialogue with government. The second thing, of course, is that we know about a number of schemes that the government is putting in place, such as the Institutions of Eminence, the Study India, and other initiatives. Though we already have conversations with the government of India in order to see if there is an opportunity to put together a project that, similar to the case of TechWeb, could be a project with universities that may support universities as they are improving their capacity. The third thing that we already have discussed is that we know, for instance, in the Higher Education Financing Agency project, HIFA, that the government is putting in place, the expectation is that the participating institutions will borrow money from HIFA, but that will pay back to HIFA based on the future returns that institutions have out of the additional revenues. So I think we can work together with institutions as they develop the capacity precisely to develop the expertise to increase those non-official revenues that institutions should have. There is fortunately a good knowledge existing in different parts of the world that can be applicable to the case of India. And the last point that I'd like to make about the collaboration is that in my role as global coordinator of higher education, I have the privilege of speaking in events all over the world. This is one of the reasons that unfortunately I have to leave later today. And I can tell you that very proudly, as much as I'm learning about the uniqueness of the higher education system, I do my best also to contribute in spreading the word about the opportunities that exist in the higher education system in India. So I hope, like myself, I'm sure many can become much more effective advocates of the importance of India higher education globally.
Thank you. One more, if there's a quick one. Yeah, please.
Sir, I would like to extend my heartfelt thanks, because we are this one of the shortlisted institution of higher learning to receive grant to the tune of 28 crores for establishing some center of excellence in Sambalpur University, which is located in the state of Orissa.
That's correct.
And we are also, you know, you have also given us fund for capacity building of faculty and students. Thank you very much.
My pleasure. And it is an honor participating. I had the privilege of visiting the institution, and again, I was very impressed. And I should tell briefly about this, because I think it is a very important role that your institutions can play. You know, bringing together and making sure that affiliated colleges become much more effective on their work, it is in the best interest of everybody. And how to make sure that universities, affiliating universities, see the affiliated colleges as true partners, and how to develop that relationship, you know that it is not easy, because you may sometimes argue that you cannot cope with too many of those challenges that those institutions face. But I think these programs like this are aimed precisely at pushing institutions to work together as true partners. And I'm very optimistic that in the case of Orissa, we will see that, but also in the case of other institutions, I think we will be able to see that more responsiveness of the universities to the realities of the colleges more effectively established.
Thank you. With that, let's join one hands once again for his.
Thank you very much to all of you. Thank you, Professor.
And Professor Francisco, we have a small formal part of activity here. May I request Professor Semten and also Professor P.B. Sharma to kindly join here to give a memento to Professor Francisco, please. It'll be a token of remembrance for all of us. Thank you for enlightening us with the potential collaborative activities which we can undertake with your support. Is there a delay? If there is a delay, we'll continue with the session. We'll do it in between. Is that fine?
Yeah.
Okay. So we'll request you to be here for some more time. And once the memento is there, we'll... It has come. Thank you.
Sorry. Sorry for disrupting the whole session.
Thank you, sir. Thank you.
I apologize.
Friends, we'll continue with the next speaker, already running late by 40 to 45 minutes. But the next speaker happens to be Professor Abhay Purohit, Executive Member of the Council of Architecture, comes from Nagpur. He'll enlighten us with the challenges and the other aspects of the architecture education in the country. Can I request you to limit it to 7 to 8 minutes, sir, and then maybe 2-3 minutes of question?
Professor P.B. Sharma, President of AIU. Professor Sandeep Sancheti, Vice President AIU. All the Honorable Vice Chancellors here. Greetings from Council of Architecture, New Delhi. When we started with the research, Professor Sharma had certain critical observations, and I allowed it, because that's what happens there. Well, I would just put it up across because I'm not going to, take up more of the time because I understand that there is pressure in terms of the time limits, and that's a good thing to happen for a success of any conference. We, Council of Architecture, is an autonomous body established under Architects Act 1972, and we have a mandate coming from the Act to basically regulate education and profession of architecture. Meaning thereby that any architect who is practicing in India has to be essentially registered with Council of Architecture in order to be known as architect by its style. Now that is what is the great mandate which has been given to us. And thereby our responsibility also has increased many folds. Presently, we have about 500 schools of architecture across India, and out of that, about 250 have come in last 10 years. But then, I realized that we also have about 800 universities. Now, when we say 800 universities and 500 colleges of architecture, then naturally, and this there are the concentrated pockets of architectural education, maybe happening basically in Maharashtra is one concentration, another is now latest addition to it is Tamil Nadu, Karnataka, and even Andhra Pradesh and Kerala. So there where the concentration is, and rest of the India, if you look at it as such, there is not a rational distribution of architectural education happening around. And that is a matter of concern. That is a matter of concern for a simple reason that it is said that when we are talking about the developing countries, and we are talking about the manpower, and we have seen the graphs which are happening around coming there, the need is about one architect per 4,000 population. Whereas we, as of date, have something like about 98,000, say roughly 1 lakh architects practicing architecture in India. And so there's a huge gap. But when this is happening around as such, simultaneously another issue which was coming in to picture is that the technological education has seen a decline over last 3 years, 4 years. And if you look at the figures, the engineering colleges are closing down. And so people have found out in order to use the infrastructure as such, they are opting for going in for establishing architectural institutions. Now when that happens, the essence is lost. Because architecture as it stands is supposed to be basically a combination of not art, neither technology. We are supposed to learn something like 52 different subjects in the process now, which takes care of society, culture, psychology, history. We are talking about the earthscape, landscape, geography, geology, climatology, ecology. So technology is a small part of it. Because essentially what we are dealing with are that we are dealing with the built environment. And if you look at the achievements of the civilization would be measured through the structures which have been erected. And that way around as such, architecture has that unique positioning. So this is what the condition is. I mean, we call that the architect is supposed to be a jack of all trades and master of beauty, utility, and stability. So when I say beauty, it is the art which is coming in. When I talk about the utility as such, it is basically the management part which is going to be a major part of it. And then when I talk about the stability, it is the technology which is going to come. And this is the traditional definition of architecture. So it reflects the aspirations of the society. These departments are very colorful departments. My request to the vice chancellors who doesn't have architecture institution in their universities is to look at it from the point of view, because you would be creating something which is absolutely meaningful for your university. It adds the color. These are the creative, extremely creative people when they come. But of course, yes, when on one side as such, I'm talking about encouraging these educational institutions to be coming in, in various parts of India. But on other side as such, there are indeed the complaints saying that, okay, but then we restrict. They say that we restrict. But well, yes, I mean, certain things would happen. For example, a professor of botany could not be, however competent he may be, could not be principal of professor of a commerce college. I mean that's the entire issue. Yes, planning indeed is a part of a part of learning in architecture, but at the same point of time, planning also is done by all disciplines. There's nothing wrong about it. I mean that you have the economical planners and you have the geographical planners, and you have the architect planners and so on and so forth. I mean, it's nothing wrong about it again, as far as planning is concerned. So a professor with a planning qualification is acceptable under the allied faculty. But that professor could not be leading the department or leading the institution, because there has to have the architect there. Another part which we have to understand is that it is a bit different sort of a branch of education, whereupon we rely mainly upon getting the field experience. going to the offices, learning from the practicing architects, going on carrying out the experiments on site, understanding the technology in that fashion. And when that is happening around SH, we encourage people from practice to come and teach with us, and which may not be suitable for our traditional system, whereupon we said that like you require such and such qualifications only which has to be there. So we, in that terms as such, our minimum standards have some variations, and also it needs a very, very different kind of a unique sort of a atmosphere. Now this is what I wanted to put up across. If at all you have any kind of questions as such, any kind of experiences, any kind of information you want to have, you can ask the questions. Thank you very much. AICT का और हमारे संबंध ऐसे है कि AICT ये बहुत बड़ा भाई है, ये बहुत ही बड़ा भाई है, because if you look at AICT, AICT giant, AICT is, I mean off the record I am telling you, AICT ये एक pampered boy है MHRD का, whereas Council of Architects is, I mean it's a small sort of nothing, but at the same point of time, yes, legally we are very, very strong. Because Supreme Court has given a ruling saying that if you are not basically affiliated with Council of Architecture as an institution, then your graduates could not be registered as architects. So that actually answers everything. You are carrying out your degree in order to practice architecture. And without getting a recognition from Council of Architecture, you cannot practice. So this is what it is. Other way around as such, all the NITs, IITs and autonomous institutions would essentially require approval from Council of Architecture, but they may not be needing so from AICT. That is what it is. So we are trying to sort it out.
Okay.
Sir, please. Ji, sir. In what, sir?
Do you think that autonomy is also a value? And the direction given by the Supreme Court is deterrent to the education, or it is a facilitator to the education?
Sir, I don't know what, I would look at it this way, please sit. I would answer, to best of my ability. I would say that like we are talking about essentially in terms of, you know, decentralization. We are talking about the wisdom of the universities and the institutions. We are talking about yeah. Yeah.
Question.
Yeah.
Do you perceive any value, rather human value, in enjoyment of autonomy?
Autonomy.
Do you perceive any human value in enjoyment of autonomy of the institution or individual?
Yeah, there are, of course. Autonomy would be giving you freedom of putting up your own thought process.
Then indoctrination in the form of the legislation or indoctrination in the form of the regimentation by the direction of the Honorable Supreme Court or by any such statutory body doesn't curtail the autonomy?
It curtails.
And when it cuts the autonomy, then it
see
is
the question.
It is against the human value.
Prohit Saab and sir, I'll request, because we'll have to save time, let the dialogue continue, one to one or one to many also.
Yeah.
Thank you so much for your views on the Council of Architecture's functioning and the activities related to architecture education. We certainly understand that they want us to join the bus. The bus is stood for beauty, utility and stability, as he was saying. Architecture is also very prominently figuring in many of our universities, and I'm sure the difficulties and the challenges which we are facing while integrating many other disciplines will be overcome through these dialogues which we are having today and later also.
Thank you.
Let's join hands for Mr. Purohit. We now have the last speaker for this particular session. We, of course, have one more, Mr. Rajesh Pankaj, who is there, but we'll request you to join in the next session. So you are kind of a one-to-one exchange between yourself and Francisco Ji. So we have the last speaker, Dr. W.G. Prasanna Kumar, CEO and the chairman of NCRI, that's the National Council of Rural Institutions. I think that's a domain which many of us need to know very well, and integrate and serve the rural folks in the rural India Let's see what we get in terms of inputs from Dr. Prasanna Kumar. Once again, request to you, sir, 7 minutes at the best.
Yeah. Thank you very much, Professor Sanchetti and Professor Singh and August audience here and my panel mates. National Council of Rural Institutes is in the business of promoting rural education. We have met many of you personally and also in the universities and also in the other regional conferences of AIU just to initiate the process of rural education. Actually, in the country, we have 4 or 5 types of rural education initiatives. We are a council like any other council, but with the distinction of handling the rural subject matter, which would mean that we enter into every area of work, whether it is rural education or rural health or rural communication or agriculture or a teacher education or social work or management or entrepreneurship. So which would mean the areas are very, very broad. I have circulated a paper to you all with an attachment which is the MHRD direction, and I've also circulated a questionnaire on the curricular framework. Any curriculum needs to have a framework and basing on which we develop the curriculum and then we work on the syllabus and then work on the transaction of syllabus. When we looked at the rural curriculum across the country, we had 4 types of courses in the country. One was a rural management course given by 4 or 5 institutions, rural development course which is given by some 12 universities, rural studies course which is given by some 17 universities, and then rural studies, rural management, rural development, and the courses which are given in terms of the priority which the students attach to the courses. If it is called as rural management, there's a first preference. Second, if it is called as a rural development course, it's a second preference. And if it is rural studies, it is a third preference. And in technological universities or technological institutes, they have rural technology course. So all these courses do not have a formal curricular framework which gives the boundary lines of the curriculum. That is one aspect which we want to work on. So the curriculum would mean, would look at the rural context and what is required. When we looked at various disciplines which have rural content in it, we looked at social work, professional social work course, teacher education course, communication course, rural communication is possibility there, teacher education, teacher engagement, rural teacher engagement is possible. In management, rural entrepreneurship is another course which is possible. So in terms of a 2 years course, if you're looking at one paper could be given with a specialization in any of these areas. And there are opportunities in employment in all these areas. But in terms of education, as a wholesome education, we have rural management course, which has value and which is valued across the country, but given by only 5 or 7 institutions, not more than that. And all of you know, IRMA is rated as the best. When IRMA was started, the interest was that we would have IRMA type of institutions across the country. That's what Kurian dreamt of, but they could not take off after IRMA, nowhere else. So it is in that context, when we looked at the possibilities of employment, yes, the enterprises working, just as the agriculture, in agriculture, those people who get trained in agriculture do not want to become farmers. Those people who get trained in rural management government do not want to work in a rural area, but they would like to work in an urban area. So that is the skewed type of position which is there. In that context, there is a need for a curricular framework which would give overall perspective and also have backward and forward linkages. The student who does this course has a field engagement in terms of internship, in terms of internship in social enterprise in a rural area, internship with the rural governance, internship with the rural enterprises, or also internship with the rural non-governmental organizations. So that type of structured exposure to rural education is not there. It's mostly theoretical in nature. Even in a case of a couple of institutions where it is called as rural management course, there's no management experience or exposure. In one place where we worked on, looked at the curriculum, they have rural studies course, which is totally econometrics and mathematics. And students did not know what they will do with that course just because the faculty members were from that background, they were giving that course. So with that type of approach, with no perspective, no curricular framework, national curricular framework for teacher education is there, school education is there, but for rural education, there's a need for such a curricular framework. That's what NCRI found. And in that context, we looked at the curriculum given by various universities, the way they have transacted. And when we approached the ministry, has given this direction to both UGC and AICT on the 7th of February last month. The circular I have also circulated to all of you. This would mean that this is one mechanical engineering course where they were looking at, the students were looking at how to develop a seed sowing machine. This is a civil engineering people who are working on the irrigation systems. So this is the vision which higher education department has to highlight the importance of rural engagement, to figure out the integral part of curriculum in university, college, deemed. So what it essentially looks at is engaging the students across the country with the rural subject matter. When we have done study of the students who are ideal after the education, we've gone to some 20 villages in and around Hyderabad. We found that the those people who are not doing anything and who are just whiling away time in the crossroads in villages are those people who are either educated young people or old, infirm, and physically challenged and pregnant people. Except that the others are working. And more people who are around in 20s are being taken care of by the work of 60 above people. So there are grandparents and parents who are taking care of the young people, which is a somersault of the approach which was earlier, where young people would take care of the older people. That's what the education system has done to them after their graduation or continuous education for 13 or 15 years of exposure. So they are not getting connected to the rural subject or rural area. So that is where is the lacuna that we found. So in that context, if we can engage the students with the rural subject matter, that is, send them to a village, have experience, have some small project done there. In fact, in the morning we had this discussion with SWIMS director who was here. They have a 5 years MBBS course where they are interested in attaching 20 families to each student, so that the student from the first day of the course to the end of the course, he would be following up the health conditions of these 20 families, and that would be his major project at the end of the course, that they are going to work with the Harvard Medical School. So in that context, the only rural engagement which is available today in the formal structure is NSS program, which is not a structured program. So we have mooted to the ministry that, and also various universities, that NSS would have a structured one semester course where rural engagement, physically the students go to the village and study that and make a report, which is an input for the which is a report based on the participatory rural appraisal, and which will be a report input for the village development plan, gram panchayat development plan.
Dr. Prasanna, can it be okay.
Yeah, I am concluding. So it is in this context that when we have these four types of courses, we require faculty development programs, we require curriculum development in this, and we require a curriculum framework overarching for all this. So that is the context in which we are working on, working with the universities across the country in developing the curricular framework. This survey paper which I've given you is an input for that. I request all of you to fill in this and give it as an input. Your opinions and your suggestions will be very, very important input. And my colleagues, as well as I am going around the country, trying to enlist the participation and support, just to address the issues linked to the rural distress. Why is that we have so many farmer suicides after so many years of independence? If you're looking at those things, then we need to work from the academic perspective also. We can't keep on blaming the administrators and political executive. So it is in that context we need to develop the faculty members as a, we need to have faculty development programs. Presently we have two faculty development programs on. We have next week, Wardha, we have a faculty development plan program, and Rajiv Gandhi University, Arunachal Pradesh, Himachal Pradesh University, there is one faculty development program. So basically we are looking at developing faculty which would be in a position to handle rural as a subject matter with rural engagement. So that is the idea. We would go through the advocacy, curriculum development, and general professional and technical education in rural engagement and professional orientation. These are the methods. We have small research projects. We have internships. We also are looking at developing the curriculum. We would like to work with the universities, which would be part of it. Though the directive of the MHRD to the UGC as well as AICT says that all higher education institutions in the country should necessarily have rural engagement of every student. That's what is the directive. But if you are giving a directive which is not implementable, it would be no use. So it is in that context we are trying to rope in the universities, rope in the higher educational institutions. We are working with NITs, IITs, and other institutions. We are parallelly working with AICT and UGC so that the capacity building programs, wherever they are held, wherever faculty development programs are held, we are part of that and we try to give inputs, and we see that nationally we'll have a standardized curriculum and also an effective curriculum which helps address the rural distress. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Dr. Prasanna Kumar, and also thank you for letting us know the requirements of rural India and the initiatives you are trying to promote. Friends, I'm very happy to tell you some of our councils and agencies are trying to get into this kind of an activity. AICT is one example which has recently initiated special internships, and one of them is going to be a rural related internship after first year of the education. So yes, we understand the importance and the needs, and I'm sure collectively we'll work for that. So once again, join hands for thanking Dr. Prasanna Kumar.
I request all of you to fill in this and give me. Thank you.
With this, friends, this particular session comes to an end. The formal part of handing over the mementos will happen in the evening around 6:30. So we request all of you to be there, including the experts. We will continue with the next session. But before that, maybe just one line. We have seen many new inputs and the initiatives coming to us through this particular session where we talked about the rural and maybe the World Bank, maybe the depository services, etc. We need to be very multidisciplinary or interdisciplinary or transdisciplinary, whatever you may think. Nothing will sit and be successful in isolation, be it the medical education, be it the commerce or architecture or any other education. And therefore, this particular session had an importance to broaden our horizons and to let us know what are the other avenues where we can expand and take advantage of others. I would like to thank all the speakers for sparing their valuable time, all the experts, and also to Professor P.B. Sharma, the Chairman, President AIU, to have led this session to begin with, and also sparing his valuable time and also sharing his thoughts. So once again, please join hands for thanking all the speakers for this session. Thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. With this, we'll not take a break because, as you know, that we are already running late by 45 minutes. We'll immediately, seamlessly move to the next session, which is an equally important, thank you, sir, which is an equally important session of interaction with the foreign delegates. May I now request Professor Furkan Kamar, if he's around, to join. And if he's not, he'll probably join us in the middle of the session. The speakers, I'll try to name and request them to kindly join us on this stage. Number one, Professor Sheel Nuna. Is Professor Sheel Nuna here? Kindly join us. He is the director, South Asia, Queensland University of Technology, Australia. Please join us, sir. Please welcome him. Dr. Tinbolt Devanley from the European Union. Kindly join us. We have Dr. Aditi Gosavi, Senior Advisor, Communication, DAAD, German Academic Exchange. Madam Gosavi, please join us. Dr. Ashwin Fernandez, Regional Director, Middle East, North Africa and India. The agency is not named here. Mr. Ashwin, is he here? Mr. Ashwin Fernandez? Okay. And we have the next speaker, or the next expert, is Mr. S.V. Chandrasekhar, AIU India, from Malaysia, representing Malaysia. Mr. Chandrasekhar, S.V. Chandrasekhar, he is also not there. We have Mr. Aditya Malkani from the Association of Commonwealth Universities. He's there, please join us. And of course, we have the Dr. Rajesh Pankaj, Joint Director of FICCI. He's also requested to join. May I request Professor D.S. Chauhan to kindly join us on the stage, sir? We'll collectively run the session, please. Professor Furkan Kamar may not join or may join us a little late for this particular session. We intend to finish as early as we can. However, we don't want to curb your interest in the session. So the session will be remaining open beyond the session, the one-to-one discussions, the discussions over a cup of tea, because after this session, we'll have a break, we'll have a cup of tea, and there they can continue. So for time being, may I request all the experts to kindly take 5 to 7 minutes, not more than that. Leave 1 or 2 minutes for the Q&A if it is possible. With that sort of a backdrop, may I first request Professor Sheel Nuna, Director, South Asia, Queensland University of Technology, Australia, to share his thoughts on this subject. Yes, sir.
Colleagues and friends, it's a great honor again to be on this platform of AIU, probably for the 17th or 18th time. The journey which I started in 1998 conference in Indore continues to be interrupted, and therefore it's always a great pleasure to be here. The topic for is the disruption in higher education, and I thought I will remind you one of the greatest disruption of the higher education in the world, which was presented by the University of Phoenix in 1976. When they started in 1976, and I will say, for the profit university, for the adult education or for the corporate education, nobody knew that whether they are going to survive. Today, the University of Phoenix is one of the largest providers of education in whole of the USA, and they continue to disrupt the higher education system, because each and everything you devise, they will disrupt it and go forward. So that is the scale of disruption. Whether it was needed or not needed, I think the history has proved it was needed, and that is the reason they are working. We at the Queensland University of Technology, long ago, Christian Dubai University as the university for the real world. The issue was, are we really the university for the real world? Are we focusing on education, or we are focusing on the skills? I think at that time, about 15 years ago, the university leadership took a decision that we are education, but we are going to focus more on skills. And I think that was the journey of disruption which started at the University, Queensland University of Technology somewhere in the early 2000s. And I will give some of the good examples of disruption at the university. We appointed two deans of the Faculty of Law who hold only the undergraduate degree. And there was a lot of hue and cry that how can somebody with a BA with a degree of LLB can be appointed as a dean of the Faculty of Law? Because there were professors, there were senior professors, everybody wanted to be the dean of the faculty. I think that was a greatest disruption. The university said, we will prove the critics wrong. We transferred them into professor if appointed the dean. We have done it twice, and even the current dean is only the LLB degree holder. He has never taught in university. And I'm underlying, the dean of the Faculty of Law has never taught in a university system. He went to the university to his undergraduate degree. Today, the law programs of the Queensland Institute of Technology is the most sought after the program. The reason being that they are not doing education, they are doing skills. So the moment the students graduate from the university, they are ready to hit the courts. That is education and the skills, it's more of the skills. If I can be a little more personal, my own appointment in 2007 at the university created a lot of hue and cry, because when I became executive position, I was giving an agenda to develop a science and technology agenda in South Asia. People thought, what the hell this person with the social background, with the social science background, and with a degree in regional planning, is going to teach us in science and technology, and that too in the countries like India, Bangladesh, and Sri Lanka. I think the critics have been proved wrong. And today, and I'm very proud to say that everybody in university want to engage in India and developing the joint collaborative project in science and technology. I will skip a few of the things about why the disruption is needed. I think there are two important things which are affecting the higher education system and are also leading to the whole issue of disruption. One is globalization. I think every university is trying to be a little more and more global. It's more important in the context of Australia, where everybody is craving for international students coming from all around the world, because the government funding is declining, and the major role of the vice chancellor is to arrange funding for the university. And therefore, everybody is going to try to get more and more students. I think there's a disruption from my own university, because the QT, like I can say on the record here, I've been saying, does not recruit students from India except for the PhD program. And that's a very conscious decision. The globalization is also becoming very important, because there's a lot of competition with the domestic students' funding. The universities do get grant from the Commonwealth government on the number of domestic students you enroll, and that determines how much funding you will get, but that funding is declining, and therefore everybody is craving for more and more international students, so there's a lot of focus on globalization. Again, there's an issue of massification, that again, the question has been coming since morning, are we talking of quantity or we are talking of quality? Are we talking of education or we are talking of skills? And that is the reason that we have to be very aware of what is really happening in the course, in the context of the massification, which is also affecting, which is also causing a lot of disruption. Having said that, whatever technology disruptions takes place anywhere in the world, the universities are bound to experience that. So therefore, whether it's a technology innovation or health innovation or any other innovations, there are some way or the other that is going to have implications for disruptions. Now I'm going to talk about the three main areas in which the disruptions are taking place. But before that, some general premises. I think the situation is changing, where the classroom lectures are being replaced by innovative and new teaching methods. The digitization is coming in a big way, and we have talked about the digitization in the previous lecture. And therefore, there's a greater emphasis on developing the personalized content and the greater access to the courses. As a result of, and I will emphasize this point, that as a result of disruption, traditional universities face competition from digitally proven universities. We are seeing in India, we are seeing in Australia, we are seeing all around the world. Now, what are the three areas which are causing this disruption in the university system? And one of the most foremost important thing is the research creates disruption. For example, you have the 3D printing. For example, you have the health implants and everything. You think of anything. The moment you do more and more research, it creates disruptions in terms of content and curriculum. The second usage is big data. Now, with the onslaught of big data, what we are looking, we are not looking for the classroom teaching. We are looking for education and skills which are more personalized. The corporate education programs have become very big in Australia, where the lot of training providers who are doing one-to-one training for the CEO of the different corporations because they are not able to find time. And therefore, it's just going to be more of personalized education. Because he has a particular CEO has a different kind of training requirements. He's not going to go to a classroom teaching or any other executive programs. What he needs is that somebody is able to design a personalized content and curriculum for the requirement is one thing. The virtual taking place in this industry. At the QT, I have seen the class size sometimes in the first or second year of engineering is about 400 to 500. But if you go to the class schedule, you will highly find 30 to 40 students attending the classroom because everything has been converted into the virtual classrooms. The moment the class the taking place, they are able to assess the live classroom lectures, what is happening in the system. So the face-to-face teaching is being replaced by the virtual teaching advantage. That's the virtual teaching advantage. I think there are six areas in which we can see that what's really happening and how the disruption is visible in the higher education system. And the very first and foremost is the perceived value of service is declining. We have talked about since the morning, and that's, if you look into the whole title of the seminar, Disruption, Entrepreneurship, and the Human Value. So the whole value which used to emphasize on education is service, and that value is declining. Now this is very important. Cost to purchase are high and have been rising more rapidly than inflation. We have been talking of the cost, but we have been rising cost, but we have been talking of the rising cost in absolute terms. If you try to relate the rising cost of education in relation to the inflation and adjust the rising cost of education with the inflation, you will find there's a phenomenal increase in the cost of education. And I have talked about it, the government funding is significant, but it's declining. It's not only declining in Australia, it is declining everywhere, and therefore people are looking for new ways, whether it's by means of disruption in the traditional ways or whatever it is, but I think we have to find a way out if we want to survive and continue to impart quality education and quality skills. Legacy organizations don't place a premium on convenience. For example, you go to the health hospital. If the hospital is closer in the locality, you have a different kind of price and you are more able to prepare. That doesn't happen in the legacy education system. And so therefore, there's some kind of mismatch. And lastly, the current business model is heavy on buildings and light on technology. You have seen everywhere that you have a nicely brick and mortar, advertise your courses in universities very well, you have a larger chunk of students attending, but when you go inside the brick and the mortar and they start looking into technology innovations, probably we start realizing what it is. So I think there are the six different ways where we are able to observe the disruptions which are taking place in the higher education system. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Please join hands for Professor Nuna. Once again, if you permit, we'll keep the questions for a later time so that you'll have one-to-one deeper interaction about the questions. We now request the second speaker for the session, Dr. Thinbold Devanle from the European Union. Please welcome him.
Hi, good afternoon. I'll try to skip the PowerPoint and be shorter and crispier, hopefully. Three messages. What is the EU? Why the EU here? And how can you work with the EU? What is the EU here? The EU, 28 countries, still including the UK. We are in India since more than 30 years, having an embassy here, about 80 people. One of the issues we deal with is higher education, which is what I'm doing, between other things, in the political section. But the EU and India is more than just trade, which is probably the first thing people have in mind. It's also political cooperation from counterterrorism, cybersecurity, maritime security, non-proliferation, Afghanistan, peace in the Middle East, etc. It's also development cooperation, although the development cooperation is phasing out since India is now graduating. And it's sectoral cooperation, in particular on environment, climate change, health, energy, urbanization, normalization, transports, migration, and etc. We also do higher education and research, which is the subject of today, but I still wanted to give you a bit of an overall picture of what the EU is and what the EU does in India. So higher education for the EU. Our program is called Erasmus, and then this research, so higher education is Erasmus, and research is Horizon 2020. Erasmus, which is probably the one I should focus on today, on higher education, is 16 billion euros total, 16 billion euros. That's for internally within the EU, and 17% of this is for outside. So 17% of 16 billion euros, I didn't do the math, but that's still quite some money. Out of this, India is one of the biggest beneficiaries in the world. I'll come to this in a second. About 50,000 students, Indian students, go every year study in the EU, some on grants and scholarships. We ourselves sponsor about 500 of them every year. We have an alumni sponsored by the EU, a pool of about more than 5,000 alumni, and there's about more than almost 2,000 researchers. Why studying in the EU? I we hear about the Brexit, we hear about terrorism, we hear about the economy of Europe going low. Well, European universities are still one-fourth of the universities in the world. Students globally, one-fifth of the global students are studying in Europe. Europe as a whole is still the first trading partner of the EU. So it has about 6,000 businesses, 5 million jobs. 5 million indirect jobs are working for or with EU companies. And that's the kind of people where we would want them to have some kind of exposure to the EU, and that is in your hands in the universities here. Good value for the money, of course. Studying in the century, in the center of London, is expensive, but the EU is very diverse. And actually, you have excellent value for the money in places where you might not know nor realize that it's a good place to send your students. And last but not least, if you take international rankings, international rankings on universities and et cetera, about 45% of those universities are in the EU. 45% of internationally ranked universities are in the EU still. But also, if you take international rankings on happiness, 7 out of 10 countries, the most happiest countries in the world, are in the EU. 7 out of 10 countries with the best air quality, that will speak to some of you more than to others, are in the EU. Go study in Estonia, you'll see the difference. 7 out of 10, and this one is my favorite, 7 out of 10 best countries for gender equality are in the EU. How many women are in this room? I counted 7, I think. Maybe now there's little more, little less. How many men? I'll let you do the math. I think we can work a lot on this. If you want to study in the EU, you'll be very welcome, ladies. And we really offer a safe environment for women to study in the EU. So that was why the EU. Four kinds of programs that we are offering to Indian universities and Indian students. The basics is the mobility. About 500 students per year that we fully finance from EU programs, the scholarships called Erasmus. There's different kind of modalities which I won't have the time to develop now. Everything is, for us, is all on our website on Erasmus. You just Google Erasmus Europa and you will find everything. It's all under the European Commission. Students get about 700 to 900 euros monthly. If it's staff and teachers, they get about 100 to 160 euros daily to teach in Europe, plus the travel costs. How to create an agreement. If you have European partners already, just ask them. They know everything. They work a lot on this within the EU, and they are eager to get more Indian partners. But they usually don't make the first step of asking their Indian partners, do you want to be in a cooperation agreement with us? But if you ask, chances are that they will actually be very excited to get European partners. Second kind of cooperation we do, it's a little bit more interesting, farther than the regular mobility, is a joint master's degree. We are building master's degrees in different places in Europe, sometimes including higher education institutions in India. There's about 20 Indian universities involved in those joint masters, and where the students go to study 6 months here, 6 months there, in an integrated program that is fully funded. Those are quite prestigious. They are work on. They are very competitive, and every student in your university can apply. Doesn't even need to apply through your university. They apply directly to some of the consortiums. And if you, as universities, want to actually build a joint master's degree with European universities. Everything, I mean, again, it's a little complicated, but I won't be able to describe it right now in my 7 minutes, which I'll try to keep. I still have two more. You just go on the website of Erasmus and you type joint master's degree, Erasmus Mundus joint master's degree, and you will see the conditions in which country, what kind of financing it is. If you want to build a joint master, it takes about a year. And the applications is from October to February. So right now is the right moment to think, if you want to do something like this, start to talk to your European partners. Number three, capacity building projects. This has benefited around 75 universities in India so far, about 30 per year. Projects which are 2 to 3 years long that deal with modernization of higher education, skilling, environment, bringing a better, safer, and fairer higher education in the world, including in India. I think gender equality is a good example of something that maybe could benefit all of us. For this, you need a certain number of European countries, a certain number of Indian universities. Again, the modalities I won't detail; they're on the website. But those capacity building are a nice tool to also work with other countries in triangular cooperations. Fourth of the projects we do and finance in India, which is the one we like in particular coming from a political angle, the Jean Monnet. Jean Monnet was one of the creators of Europe, a French citizen who had the first vision of the integration of Europe. And now Jean Monnet is a grant to individual teachers and professors who teach anything European in their universities. Financing is between 30 to 50, a little bit more, thousand euros, 30,000 to 50,000 euros. There's different modalities. You have centers of excellence and et cetera. And for this, if you have anyone in your universities that is either from Europe and is able to teach a certain number of hours on something European, which doesn't need to be political, anything on trade, history of art in Europe or anything, those grants are actually quite interesting, and there's not enough Indian applications, so the Indians are already always a little pushed to apply for this one. Last but not least, research. Marie Curie scholarships, same principle, different timing. If you're interested, just Google Marie Curie in French scholarships. The co-funded mechanisms, it would take a little too long to explain, but on the research side, we used to completely offer grants. Now it's only co-funded. We did a lot on water recently. Currently, we're on health and biotechnologies. Type Horizon 2020 on Google, EU Horizon 2020, and you'll get more about those research opportunities. Can I go through my question and answers? Because I know that I usually get the question, so what about the Brexit? You know, what's happening? What does it change? Well, with or without the UK in the EU, those numbers that I gave you are actually, and surprisingly, not that much relying on the EU. Now, of course, for India, a lot of the Indian students going to study abroad are going to the UK, but those numbers are shrinking quite quickly, and other countries are getting into it, especially Germany and France. The president was here last week, President Macron. and he promised to actually double the number of Indian students in the French universities. And there's a lot of smaller countries which you may not know much about, which have great programs at a great quality for the money for your students and for individual universities. I usually get the question on brain drain. Yeah, great to send our kids abroad, but then they stay there and then we lose them in India. Well, not that much. 87% of the scholarships we gave, 87% came back. It's quite one of the lowest rates among international countries. So there is not such of a brain drain as you could expect. I have more, but I don't have time for it. But I could individually answer more questions.
Thank you so much, Dr. Devan Lay. Please join hands for thanking him. Thank you for maintaining the time. I'm sure all of us are craving for internationalization. Many questions are there, whether it's Brexit or non-Brexit, doesn't matter. We'll have one-to-one discussions with you as long as you are available with us this evening. I now continue to be in the European domain and request Dr. Aditi Gosavi, Senior Advisor Communications, DART, from the German Academic Exchange. Please take your 7 minutes, madam.
Yeah, well, following your footsteps, even I will relegate my pen drive to my pocket and then go without a presentation in interest of time. So, ladies and gentlemen, dignitaries on the dais as well as dignitaries in the audience, it's a pleasure and honor for me to be here today. And it's I've been placed rather well right after the EU, because then that means that a lot of things I do not have to repeat. Germany is, at the end of the day, a part of the European Union. And so a lot of things that were mentioned just now, whether it is the policy, whether it is the funding schemes, if not exactly the same, they are pretty much similar. But yeah, coming back to what I thought of sharing with you today was, I think we no longer need to debate whether a change is required or not. We know that change is necessary, and the kind of change that we are talking about is not just in terms of systems, but also in terms of humans, and such a change can at best start at universities. So how can this change? May it be a change in syllabi, in methodology, in student perspective, in training, be brought about? And this is where I would like to go back to the motto of the organization that I represent here, the German Academic Exchange Service, or DAAD. It's a simple sounding little motto, three-word motto: change by exchange is what the motto is. What exchange it is, we have anyway taken a look at right from the morning. We've been talking about who needs to change, what needs to change. There were themes such as cooperation, collaboration, single change, individual change, and so on. But how has Germany tried and rather successfully managed this exchange? A landmark in this is what happened in the year 1999, the Bologna process. 29 European countries came together and agreed upon creating a structure of comparable degrees, of transparent credit systems, thereby increasing the attractiveness of the European higher education area in general. And if I may say so, Germany was fierce at it. It also, for example, meant getting rid of the renowned German diplome. So the diplome does not exist in Germany anymore. Germany follows this very structured system of bachelor's, master's, and then comes the PhD. So this was also something that happened after the Bologna process. What Germany did next was to set up the Excellence Initiative. The aim was to promote top-level research, improving the German higher education as well as research landscape. This happened and it helped a great deal in increasing Germany's international competitiveness. Of course, there was much more that went into both the Bologna process and the Excellence Initiative, but this is just highlighting a few aspects, because what I'm trying to do here is, because in the previous sessions also we decided that best practice is not a terminology that we will use, so I'm just presenting a good practice, given accepting the understanding that not every best practice example can be applied elsewhere. So as such, I present to you what Germany did, and one can always think and contemplate which of it can be picked up in what manner, how it can be fine-tuned, so on and so forth. Right. So the results of these two, the Bologna process and the Excellence Initiative, were very much visible. And today, Germany happens to be the third largest or the third most important destination for students worldwide. So it follows, of course, UK and the US, English-speaking countries, obvious reasons. One does not need to deal with why and how. But Germany does not speak German, or it did not speak German, and that was also an angle that it added to the offer that it made to the whole world, the language. German university campus today, I mean, being the third most popular destination, the German university campus is extremely colorful. It has almost 30% of all the registered students who are international, which happens to be a very high rate, and I dare say that the US falls far behind in that case. And here we are not really counting on people whose parents had their careers there and people who were born there. We are talking about those people who are going there in order to study or in order to carry out their research. Coming home again, looking at the number of Indian students choosing Germany as a destination, the number has increased, has doubled in the past 4 years already. Today it stands above 15,500 odd students. And when I mention this number, the nice thing, I'm always happy to say that, is that this is not real. This number does not include the number of exchange semester students. This number does not include the number of scientists who go there for 3 months, 6 months, 1 year. These are all students registered only in bachelor's, master's, or PhD degrees. So these are the numbers, and if one were to include the other numbers also in there, then the numbers would be really much more impressive than the ones that I just shared with you. But fine, I've already moved into the research zone, because just going by the student numbers is not really saying anything about exchange, because students will go wherever they see good opportunities, whether it is in terms of education or eventually in terms of career. But a true and a more complete exchange can happen only once cooperation and collaboration sets in. And for that, one needs to go a step beyond and actually act proactively, work proactively on these aspects. And for this, there are various German organizations, the DAAD being one, the DFG you might be aware of being another, and many other universities and institutions have already set up their liaison offices. Their main task is not attracting students, but supporting cooperations and collaborations and helping people with the word that people laugh at, but matchmaking. And that is what is necessary, and that is being seen as important by German universities individually also. But that's not it. The German Ministry for Foreign Affairs has also set up a big project called the German House for Research and Innovation, known as the DWIH, which is led by the DAAD and has as its member 15 German institutions of higher education, research, and funding. So these institutions also have, I mean, this institution also carries out various projects that move more importantly in the field of research and innovation. Again, something that brings us closer to the theme that we are here today to talk about.
Can
yes, please.
One more minute.
Am I overstood? Yeah. Oh, well, then let me just end with a message, because we talked about it. We can talk about the rest of it later. But then, yes, it's my wish would be that all our intentions, aspirations be alike, so that the common objective can unite us all. This sounds very familiar, I know, and that is not because it has been repeated through the morning. It's also not because it's some German line that one says. But then today the talk was also about going back to the Indian roots and finding out what was said in India. And what I just presented was a word-to-word translation of something that many of you would know as Samaniva Akuti, Samana Hridaya Niva, and so on and so forth. Right. Thank you so much.
Thank you. Thank you, Dr. Gosavi. Thank you for maintaining time as well. We will continue in the same domain, where the horizons will expand a little bit more now. So we have Mr. Aditya Malkani from the Association of Commonwealth Universities. Obviously, they will also represent some part of the Europe. And Mr. Malkani also happens to be from the local Banaras, which I came to know about him during this morning. So welcome, Mr. Aditya Malkani.
Thank you. Thank you, Professor Sancheti. It's a real pleasure and an honor to be here. As you said, that my roots are right here in the holy city of Banaras, where my great-grandfather was the dean of the teacher training college at Banaras Hindu University, which is now the Faculty of Education. So it indeed is an honor and a privilege to be back and addressing the esteemed audience here. Thank you, Professor Sharma, for all your hospitality, Professor Kamar, other colleagues at the AIU. I'm also proud to say that our Association of Commonwealth Universities are delighted to be partners of the Association of Indian Universities. We've signed an MOU a few months ago and are working on a number of very interesting joint initiatives together. I also know that we all subscribe to the philosophy that knowledge knows no boundaries and that international collaboration is an essential form of raising the success of universities and broadening horizons. I think that's even more important in today's highly interconnected world, where it's an important part of university activity to broaden the horizons of our students by providing them with opportunities to study abroad, broadening the horizons of our faculty by providing them with opportunities to study abroad, exchange, so on and so forth. I don't want to be repetitive, and also in the interest of time, I'm going to keep this very, very short. We all know that the best way to actually understand diverse cultures are by interacting, working with people from different parts of the world, and also by traveling to different countries. Our association, which is the Association of Commonwealth Universities, is the world's first and oldest international university network, established way back in 1913. We're very proud to have over 520 university members across over 50 Commonwealth countries. And our largest group of members happens to be right here in India. I also have the privilege of being the first appointee of the ACU outside our office, which is in London. I'm based here in India with, of course, very frequent travel to London and to other Commonwealth countries. And my remit is in representing the ACU in South Asia. We've only just started. I've only been in this role for a few months. But I must say that many of these recent weeks have been spent traveling to different member universities and meeting with our various member universities. And I must say that the enthusiasm for working with the ACU is something that I'm very, very impressed by. Our work is in a variety of different areas. We work with early career academic grants, providing your young academics at the very early stages of their careers with opportunities to travel abroad, attend conferences, and work on joint projects with their peers in different parts of the Commonwealth. Our work is also in student mobility, something that we increasingly want to see with Indian universities. A large part of our work is in supporting gender workshops. One of our colleagues earlier talked about gender, and I must say that's a very important part of our agenda as well. We work with the Martha Farrell Foundation based in Delhi on supporting a number of scholars to come and be part of important gender workshops. We're looking to host a conference in India either later this year or sometime next year. And that's a conference where we'd like to attract speakers from across the Commonwealth to come and share their views and their aspirations. And we'd like this conference to be one that's focused not particularly on vice chancellors, because vice chancellors, of course, have opportunities to attend a number of conferences, but to be focused on pro-vice chancellors or senior representatives of universities who can then go in and actually implement a number of the conversations that are discussed during our conference. So I'm going to keep this extremely short because we have time constraints, and we also know that with the advent of the internet, you have a lot of information available online. I'd certainly urge you to look at our website, to look at the various different programs and grants that we have on offer. And I'd also like to urge you to engage, ask questions if you have any, because I'm here for the next 2 days as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Aditya Malkani. Thank you. We now move on to the last speaker for the session, and that is Dr. Rajesh Pankaj from FICCI. Mr. Rajesh, first of all, thanks to you for accommodating a small shift between the sessions. I request you to give your point of view on our association with FICCI and the work in the education space.
Thank you so much, distinguished dignitaries in the dais and academic leaders in the audience. You know, it's a real privilege to represent FICCI in the 92nd annual general meeting of Association of Indian Industry. You know, something which perhaps may have been happening for the first time, in the sense that you know, this is a conglomeration where you have all the vice chancellors of various universities of India, and an intervention from an industry association body like FICCI perhaps will bring a different perspective, or maybe some new perspective, to this whole engagement of stakeholders in higher education space. FICCI is one of the first industry association body of India which forayed into the area of higher education. Out of plethora of activities that we do, all of that we do in FICCI is done in an earnest effort to bring right kind of reform. The requisite reform that is required of in the sector is what the intent is. And we work through a very buoyant higher education committee, which again gets represented by academic leaders like Professor Furkan Kamar way back. In fact, he's been there for the past several years, and also Professor P.B. Sharma. I mean, senior academic leaders are the movers and shakers of what we do at FICCI. We came out with a very, very historic document called FICCI Vision 2030. On higher education, which was released in 2013, and something that is being referred, that was referred by who's who in higher education space, and a lot of the elements which is discussed in the new education policy finds a mention in the draft, a lot of it that was discussed in the vision policy, finds a mention in the new draft education policy that Government of India is currently working on. We also, have reviewed various acts that Government of India has moved on from time to time. Way back in 2008 when AICTE, was being reviewed for the first time, to 2010, when we had several bills that was initiated in the parliaments, though none of them could see the light of the day, like Foreign Education Bill and Accreditation Bill and Tribunal Bill and all of that. And to the new education policy, which is still being deliberated upon in MHRD. We've had a physical presence. We have presented our viewpoints to the Parliamentary Standing Committee on Human Resource Development. We have presented our viewpoints to the task force chairman. In fact, we recently had Mr. K. Kasturi Rangan committee that kind of had invited us to make our views to the panel. And all this kind of comes through the inputs of the committee members that we have. In the interest of time, I'll just kind of touch upon three or four key things where we could have the member institutions of AIU engage with FICCI. In an earnest effort again to augment the quality of higher education in the country. There's something called Study in India, which Government of India has just announced, and ETSL is being appointed as a nodal agency to implement it. But we've had two rounds of discussion in Ministry of HRD and also in Ministry of Commerce, and in all likelihood, FICCI is also going to be one of the partners of this Study in India initiative. The modality, the framework, what are the elements that Study in India should have? One of the things that we found at FICCI, of course, there are a lot of things that needs to be worked upon in higher education space in India in terms of bringing in, streamlining the sector, in addressing the issues which are there. But despite all of this, we sincerely feel that India still has a lot of good, highly reputed institutions in the country doing great work, but unfortunately does not get represented, and especially in the international forums, it's not that, we don't have. Given whatever shortcomings and whatever bottlenecks that currently exists, even then, because if that was not the case, then why would we have all this top of the line MNC CEOs and chairmen and other guys, who've passed out from this higher education system which was existing 20, 30 years ago, and they're still making it great. So it's just not possible. The people who are passing out get recognized, claimed, but the institutions perhaps does not. One of the things that we found was, because we do a lot of delegations, focused delegations overseas. I mean, delegations not for the sake of it, but delegations for bringing in right kind of value, small, big. We've had 20 plus countries delegations over the past 7, 8 years. One of the things that we find is that India, unfortunately, does not get represented effectively in a very cogent, coherent manner, the way you have countries like Cuba and name a country, you know, you've not even heard about it, and they represent their higher education way in a very, very effective and very efficient way, which does not happen with India. I mean, forget about IITs and IIMs. You know, IIT and IIMs perhaps does not cater even 1% of the, you know, the higher edge, the gross enrollment ratio that we currently have. In fact, there are a lot of good, you know, unsung institutions in country doing amazing work. But that is something which MHRD, the erstwhile, the current minister, the Prakash Javadekarji, had in one of the meetings said that perhaps we as a country need to identify three or four big shows that happens overseas. And we have to package India in a way and present it to the wider world that, look, this is what it is in the current setup, and you'll have a lot of traction. And as a supplement to that, you know, Ministry of Commerce has a scheme called MAI, Market Access Initiative, you know, where that's something that that works across sectors. Of course, education is one of them. How do you promote trade and investment in the sector? So they earmark certain amount of money where they try and bring buyers. It's called reverse buyer seller meet. Of course, of education, we can't be using the word buyers. So it's more to do with focused one-on-one engagement with international higher education providers. So Vifiki does a major conference in the month of November. In fact, this year, 2018, the 14th version. Of course, again, Professor Furqan Kamar has been an integral part of that the deliberation process as to what is to be discussed, what was discussed last year. It started off as a conference, but it's become a forum of very serious policy deliberation and sharing of best practices and getting right kind of value for the participants. The 14th version, which is happening on 30th and 31st of October in Vigyan Bhavan this year, you know, again, is something where Ministry of Commerce has come on board, and they're funding, you know, they'll be funding 250 international, you know, higher education providers. That's FICCI for FICCI to kind of shortlist, and these would be from 65 plus countries. You know, we've always had 1200 plus delegates in the conference representing 60 plus countries, from, and with that constitutes about 300 international delegates. Now, these are the higher education providers who would be coming would be primarily from regions like Southeast Asia, East Asia, Africa, Middle East. You know, not that you know, we don't want delegates from Europe and North America, but I mean, these are the low-hanging fruits that we have. So most of the international students who come to India to pursue a full-fledged program are the ones who come from these regions, which then kind of comes close to 65 countries. So we then kind of invite the vice chancellors, directors, deans, three or four from each of these countries who come and participate at FICCI Forum. And in an earnest effort to increase the flow of international students, which currently exists somewhere close to 22, 23, 24,000, which we have to kind of increase and take. The whole idea ultimately is to project India as a destination of higher education, wherein we also expect all the students from developed world come and pursue a full-fledged program and not just do a cultural exchange, 1 week, 10 days program. So that is one Start in India initiative where we find a very, very prominent window to kind of institutionalize this whole process and then kind of, you know, pitch India as a destination of higher education, you know, as a hub of higher education to the world. And that's one area that we're looking at. The second thing that I also wanted to highlight was that there's a conference called NAFSA, which happens every year in the US. So, you know, we've had all the countries of the world, 150 plus countries, go and participate, but we never had India as one pavilion. Last year was an attempt that FICCI made with the partnership of MHRD again and MOCI, Ministry of Commerce. This year again, it's happening in Philadelphia, just trying to kind of work around, you know, if there could be a robust and more effective, you know, delegation mounted. And when we say delegation, there are a lot of other engagements that we plan around it, you know, the way we did it last year, and that was in, you know, LA. So that's the other thing that we kind of, you know, we would want to kind of engage with. In the higher education summit, I would request all the vice chancellors, in fact, to kind of try and see if your diary permits and block your diary. We'll be sending more information for this 14th edition of FICCI Higher Education Summit, and would really request you all to kind of come and engage an open window for international participants, and not just international delegates per se, but the discussion that happened is a lot to do with what is happening, because last year it was education 4.0, leapfrogging to education 4.0, student at the core, you know, so whatever we do has to do with students, you know, whether we devise a policy or do whatever. So that is something that we've kind of started deliberating on, and this year we're planning to work around as to how do we execute education 4.0, you know, so all this 21st century education that we're talking about, how do universities adapt to the changes of, you know, the education 4.0, industry 4.0 requirements. So that's something that we're going to deliberate on. In fact, we have come out with a report which says, you know, FICCI Future of Jobs 2022, where we talk about the fact that by 2022, 9% of the jobs would be the ones that do not exist today, and 37% of the jobs would require a lot of, you know, radical change in terms of the skill set that we possess, and 54% would remain the way it is, in fact. So the discussion that we'll have in the conference would be much to do with disruptive technology, innovation, entrepreneurship. In fact, we've also, I'll just take 2 minutes, 1 minute maybe, to kind of quickly wrap up and talk about a major initiative that we plan to do with the Andhra Pradesh government. You know, it's called Center of Excellence on Grassroots Innovation. Andhra Pradesh is one of those forward-looking states in the country, and we've seen this government functionary working like a corporate, you know, getting emails at 11 in the night. And the vision document which Chandrababu Naiduji has come out with, Sunrise 2029, finds a clear mention on FICCI AP COE on grassroots innovation, which will be set up in Vizag. And there's another national knowledge functional hub, which has to do with institute industry engagement, and creating an ecosystem so that industry institute engagement takes place at all levels. We are setting up a center at Sri Venkateshwara University, SV University, Tirupati, and I see the Vice Chancellor, Professor Damodaran, sitting here. So that was also something which Chief Minister himself had signed in the FICCI, last FICCI years, FICCI conference. So these are the two projects that we plan to do in Andhra Pradesh in with participation of universities and industry, and would want to replicate such. In fact, this center also, the state government is very clear to, you know, to ensure that we have participation from all over. So when it goes up and running, we'll use virtual technologies and to bring in more participation from other states. We'll be more than happy to engage with, you know, other universities and state governments on similar such projects. So with these words, I would want to conclude. I'll be happy to take up questions. Yeah.
Thank you. We'll let the questions flow to you a little later, or maybe on one-to-one basis. Thank you, Dr. Rajesh Pankaj. FICCI, of course, was supposed to be in the earlier session, but that session was not meant for internationalization. But I saw that Mr. Rajesh Pankaj changed gears and talked most about the internationalization. So thank you so much for that. Friends, with that, all the speakers have given their inputs, and the deliberations anyway will continue. Just a small concluding word, because we are running short of time. I think the first speaker, Professor Nuna, talked about disruptive things, and of course the biggest disruptions which we are coming across is in the education, is that we talk about learn, unlearn and relearn. That's the biggest disruption, that how do you take the things out of your head and how do you make your memory again clean and then again rejig it with something new and something very different and do it very often. I think that's the biggest disruption which is happening. One of the disruptions which has always fancied me is that which will happen in our kitchen possibly, that you'll have the machine sitting like your ovens and other things, which will print 3D pizzas and anything with any topping, with any dough or base or whatever it may be. So disruptions are anyway the order of the day. Disruptions have made our history for the last 200 years. If you listen to some of the experts, you'll probably know that. The other speaker, Dr. Devan Lay, was talking about the Erasmus, the extent of funding which is available, the extent of jobs which are related to the European funding, and the kind of numbers they are attracting, at least from India, in terms of research things, not the short-term activities. And of course, Europe happens to be one of the very happy, you can say, continents, as you are very boldly claiming. We certainly have taken advantage of that in India. German, obviously known for its very precision, presence everywhere, wherever there is a quality. I think the German name obviously occurs. We really like what you said, change by exchange. Change is the order of the day, and exchange is what you are promoting. I'm sure we'll take advantage of that in India, and you'll also gain something in return from India, because one-way traffic will not generally sustain for long in terms of activities. Two of the experts were not present, friends here, Dr. Ashwin Fernandez and Dr. S.V. Chandrasekhar. In case they are available, they can be slotted tomorrow for some other session if they would like to continue and give their deliberations here. We had the second last speaker in form of Mr. Aditya Malkani. We all know that ACU is a big time partner for AIU, and we intend to do lots of activities jointly. And obviously the knowledge has no boundaries, and so is the case with ACU has no boundaries. ACU is omnipresent, though the number wise we can boldly claim that we have more memberships here because of our growth, but their presence, global presence, is very good, and no doubt that they are one of the oldest network of the world in terms of associations or universities network, and we will take advantage of that. And lastly, Dr. Rajesh Pankaj talked about the higher education policy or vision document which they launched in 2013. I think it was very well worked upon, and then obviously followed by many of us. And since then, I've seen, my own observation is, the FICCI's November conference has become a very sought after event where a lot of people come and crave to learn and exchange ideas. And I'm sure FICCI will also be partnering with AIU to do more activities. So with this, we'll bring this session to the close. A few announcements before you leave your seats. Number one, that thanks to all the distinguished speakers, especially coming from abroad, spending their valuable time with us and also sharing their thoughts. So please join hands to thank all the speakers once again. My thanks to Professor D.S. Chauhan. Of course, I was requesting him to lead the session, but he said, no, you please continue to do so. But his presence itself is very heartening and enlightening. Thank you, sir, for your kind presence. And thanks to all the organizers for giving us this opportunity to run the session. With this, the session comes to an end. We'll break for tea. I think Professor Furkan Kamar is going to make the announcement, but we'll soon meet for the business session of the AIU. Thank you.
Thank you very much for giving the good news that we shall also have a tea break. May I request President AIU to please come on stage for just a minute. Before we break for tea, if you give me 3 minutes, that will save you 30 minutes. So I thought that we take this 3 minutes. And with the president in chair, sir, with your permission, we officially call house to order for business session. But as you all know that for business session, we have a quorum requirement. With 682 universities as members and 1/3 being quorum, we need more than 230 university vice chancellors present here. Official attendance today is 153 or something is the number. It means we are not meeting the quorum. But one of our rules says that if we do not meet quorum, then we can adjourn for half an hour and we can resume for the business session. So with the permission of the chair, may I propose to adjourn the business session for half an hour and we resume, because in that case we shall be meeting the quorum requirement and we will save 30 minutes of our time. Is it okay? Thank you very much, sir.
You have my permission to adjourn the session for half an hour.
Thank you very much, sir. Thank you very much, sir. And you are now most welcome for tea.